NCAA College Football Bowls 1978 is a feature presentation of the nation's leading independent, the Mizlou Television Network.
Yellow 19, 1-3, ready?
From the Kingdome in Seattle, Washington, this is Olympia Challenge Bowl 2. Olympia Challenge Bowl 2 is brought to you by Olympia Beer. Olympia, come taste a winner. Taste Olympia. Toyota. Toyota hopes you'll enjoy today's 1979 Challenge Bowl. Toyota has got your 1979 car or truck. See them now at your local Toyota dealer. You asked for it, you got it. Toyota. By Dean Ritter Reynolds, one investment firm you'll be glad to hear from. And by Pepsi-Cola and your local Pepsi-Cola bottler. Have a Pepsi day.
Kingdome in Seattle, Washington. It's time for the 1979 Olympia Challenge Bowl game featuring the All-Stars from the Pac-10 against the All-Stars from the Big 8. Hi, everybody. I'm Steve Grad with Len Dawson and Don Perkins. Welcome to the Great Northwest. We're expecting an outstanding football game here tonight. The Pac-10, coached by John McKay, formerly from Southern Cal, now with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. The Big 8, coached by Bud Wilkinson, now with the St. Louis Cardinals, but building up those great teams from Oklahoma. Now, both the gentlemen working with me, Len Dawson and Don Perkins, have had lots of experience with these all-star games and big confrontations. Gentlemen, what kind of an effect does it have on the players to not only be an all-star for themselves, but also for their conference?
Steve, thanks for saying that in a gentlemanly way. I think what you mean that Don and I are old. Well, that's not really true. I'm not. I remember when I was a youngster, a man with the Dallas Cowboys wore the number 43 on his jersey. I used to watch him and idolized him all of the time. This is going to be, I think, a very fun game for us. But what about the players, Don? How do you think they're going to react to this game?
Len, first of all, I have to set the record straight. I played 9 years in the National Football League. Len Dawson played 19 years. Now that we've got that out of the way, the incentive is here. There's a lot of pro scouts. We've talked about them all week. It means money in the bank for these players. Not only that, they've got pride in their individual schools. They've got conference pride. It's all on the line out here. But that notwithstanding, these guys are athletes. They're competitors. They came out here to have a good time. And you know very well that you only have a good time, Lynn, if you play well. So they'll play well out here this evening. They'll be playing like they're playing for the NCAA championship and the Super Bowl all combined in one. There'll be a lot of hard hitting, a great ball game.
I think you're right. And we're going to take a look at some of the matchups coming right up, right after this important timeout.
At a time like this, you probably don't care that we carbonate our beer naturally, or use only choice barley malt, or pure artesian brewing water. But you'd taste the difference if we didn't, so we do. Olympia. It's the water, and a lot more.
I've been looking at all the new cars, and I'm still looking. Toyota, what do you got?
The 1979 Toyota Corolla two-door sedan. The lowest-priced Toyota.
You got a Toyota.
The Corolla is a combination of engineering, functional styling, and Toyota quality.
You got a Toyota. Solid, dependable, a real car value. You got it coming to you. You got a Toyota. You got it.
Power-assisted front disc brakes, standard.
You got it.
Sure-footed McPherson strut front suspension, standard.
You got it, Toyota.
The 1979 Toyota Corolla. If you can find more value in a small car, buy it.
Toyota, you got it.
You asked for it. You got a Toyota.
What if you woke up tomorrow And it wasn't winter. It's summer in Southern California, and Western's got a sunbreak fly-dry vacation for you in Southern California for only $104 plus airfare. 4 days, four nights in Southern California, only $104. It's from Western Airlines, the only way to fly. Call your travel agent or Western. Double occupancy rates, airfare extra.
Hello from Seattle and welcome to the Challenge Bowl matchup. Our matchup today is brought to you by Grecian Formula 16. Grecian Formula 16 lets you control how much gray hair you slowly get rid of. Some of it, most of it, or all of it. Hello again, I'm Don Tollefson back at Mizlou Network Control, and we are very excited today about the second annual Challenge Bowl because this is a unique concept in all-star games. We are pitting conference against conference, and the players are playing for the pride of their conference. Last year, the Pac-10 just hung on to beat the Big Ten. This year, they're taking on the best players from the Big Eight. Let's meet some of those Big Eight performers right now, and today we have two quarterbacks who really put on a show in the Orange Bowl. First of all, Oklahoma quarterback Thomas Lott, Mr. Bandana, the guy who loves to wear all those different bandanas. He'll be one of our quarterbacks. The other quarterback, Nebraska's Tom Sorley. And you'll remember that he directed the Nebraska comeback that just fell short of the Oklahoma Sooners in that Orange Bowl game. On defense, a couple of the performers to watch for today, linebacker Lee Coons out of Nebraska. He's a young man from Golden, Colorado, but he didn't go to Boulder. He headed for the University of Nebraska. And the coach today of the Big Eight All-Star team, Bud Wilkinson of the St. Louis Cardinals, who was such a legendary man at the University of Oklahoma and gained a lot of respect this year when he came to St. Louis, had a tough start, but rebounded for a very, very decent season with the St. Louis Cardinals. Well, as I mentioned, the Pac-10 last year won this Challenge Bowl. They're hoping to do the same thing here today, and they have an awful lot of horses to take on the Big Eight. We'd like to meet four of those horses right now. We're going to start with the quarterback today. They call him the Throwing Samoan. His name is Jack Thompson. He's out of Washington State University. He came from Seattle, Washington, and the pro scouts say he's an outstanding professional prospect. Our tight end today is a guy you might have heard of as well. His name, Lamar Lundy. He played his college ball at California. His dad, the NFL star of the same name. Over on the defense, a couple of guys to watch for today from the University of Southern California, defensive lineman Rich Dimmler. He's out of Bayonne, New Jersey, and he came all the way across the country to perform and perform well for the Trojans of Southern Cal. And finally, linebacker Jerry Robinson from the University of California at Los Angeles. Philadelphia Eagles coach Dick Vermeil, who used to coach at UCLA, says Jerry Robinson is probably the best college linebacker in years. And finally, our coach today for the Pac-10, John McKay. Just like Bud Wilkinson, he was a brilliant, legendary college coach at the University of Southern California, and now he is in the pros with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
The game is underway, and it was a Pac-10 winning the toss. They received it. They are now about the 30-yard line. This is third down coming up. Good run by the fullback, James Owens, or halfback James Owens, number three. It's coming up now. You did miss one play in that first play, the Throwing Samoan. Jack Thompson threw an incompleted pass. So it's third down now and approximately 4 yards to go. Taking a look at that starting backfield, we've got Jack Thompson, 14 at quarterback, number three, James Owen, the running back, and the fullback, number 27, Theotis Brown.
Third and three at the 38.
Owens out. Number 21, Lynn Kane, is in the ball game from USC. Rollout. Pressure. He's got a man open. Number 81, Lamar Lundy Jr., in and out of the hands of Lamar Lundy Jr., and that name is quite familiar to me, Don, because his father, Lamar, and I played together at Purdue University. But it's coming up short. It's now fourth down. They're in a punting situation now for the Pac-10.
And, Len, you could tell the teams hadn't worked together too long as we're looking at number four, Marty King, who kicks 41.6 yards a kick.
Jim Rogers.
They've got Jimmy Rogers back deep in a single safety trying to receive the punt, and they're not putting any pressure on the punter, and that's one of the rules of the game. But it goes to the short man.
It's Bill Fisher, number 31, the defensive back for Kansas State that caught that short kick that time by Marty King. So pretty good field position now for the Big Eight as they get their first opportunity to move the football.
Well, let's take a look at that offensive unit of the Big Eight coming in here. Let's take a look at the backs first. Number 12, Tom Sorley of Nebraska will be starting at quarterback. Number 34, Jimmy Rogers at halfback. Number 21, Mike Kozlowski from Colorado at fullback. Quick screen. Fumble. That's Robinson. To about the 5-yard line. Fine linebacker. Number 84, Jerry Robinson of UCLA came up with a fumble, getting it down to the 5-yard line, Don, and right now it looks like they're in great position to score.
Well, the Big Eight came out throwing this time, and I'm sure Tom Sorley wishes that he had not. He got the ball on target right away, though, to Charlie Green, but right there, Charlie had not tucked the ball away. You see, 84, Jerry Robinson, three-time All-American, come up with that interception from UCLA, and Robinson does a good job as a runner. He's a fine defensive ball player.
And you can credit number 88, Jerry Wilkerson, the defensive end, for knocking that ball loose. It's wide. Here is the speedster going wide. It's number 3, James Owen, the world-class hitter, and it's in for a touchdown. Right away, it's the Pac-10 getting in for 6. First play from the 5-yard line, James Owens, number 3 from UCLA.
A lot of good effort that time, too, by Owens. You're going to see Mike Clemens there. He had a shot at him at about the 5-yard line. Owens has got a lot of speed. Quite a track man also. Right there is number 17, Clemens. And looks like he has him in his grasp but cannot hang on to him. Fine second effort, and Owens goes in.
Now we've got Paul Watson in for the extra point try. It's up, and it's good. So right now, early in the ball game, Pac-10 getting a big break, coming back with a touchdown. They're ahead 7-0. And we'll be back with more action after these messages from your local station.
Do you know about the child care credit that could save you up to $800 on your income taxes? Are you taking advantage of every allowable deduction and credit? I'm Henry Block, president of H&R Block. Our tax specialists are trained to save you money. And that's my number one reason why you should let us do your taxes this year.
H&R Block. There's an office nearby to serve you.
That's from Billy Joel, My Life. You're on KINK.
Listen carefully. Every album preview on KINK Radio in 1979 can be yours if you use your imagination. In 10 words or less, describe Kink Radio. And if your entry is chosen, we'll award you 261 record albums. Listen to FM 102 for details.
All right, we're ready for the kickoff. It's going to be the kicker from Washington State, Paul Watson, kicking off. He just completed that extra point. And the deep men are two speedsters, Jimmy Rogers and Charles Green. Rogers is from Oklahoma, Green from Kansas State. Not much room. He's tackled on about the 22-yard line. Really haven't set the offensive unit so far for the Big Eight. We did give the starting backfield, Tom Sorley, 12 of Nebraska, 34 Jimmy Rogers, Oklahoma will be a halfback, 21 Mike Kozlowski from Colorado, the fullback. Taking a look at the wide receivers, 24 Charlie Green from K-State will be one receiver. Ray Hardy, number 22 from Iowa State, will be the other receiver. Guy Preston, number 88 from Iowa State, the tight end.
Tom Lott carrying the ball on that one, Len. This is interesting. Lott was sort of down with the flu this week, and he's going to be playing running back this evening. As everyone knows, of course, he was the great quarterback on that Oklahoma ball club this year, but he's going to take a shot as a running back.
Well, you talk about running. He had the flu all week long, and he only got an opportunity to practice one day. The last play, it was Kim Anderson, 22, and Bruce Beakley, the middle linebacker, making the stop. Tom Sorley, Nebraska, number 12, under the center. Handing off the fullback, coming up the middle of the line. He's tackled by number 92, Rich Dimmler.
6'6", 256-pound defensive tackle out of USC.
Good look at Kozlowski, the ball carrier on that one. He's a 6'2", 192 running back from Encinitas, California, played for the University of Colorado as we look at that Pac-8 huddle, Big 8 huddle, that is.
I think in this ball game they're going to have to throw the football to get any yardage. Quick out. Good catch. Charlie Green, number 24 out of K-State. He led K-State. Check that again. That's 28.
Ray Hardy from Iowa State. He was the receiver on that one, Len.
We're going to get all these players straightened out here in a minute now.
They're shuffling them in and out of there pretty good.
They're going to shuffle the wide receivers in to call the plays because the plays are being called from the bench by both sides. The wide receivers for the Big 8 will be coming into the ballgame. There's Thomas Lott breaking up and showing his great running ability, coming up for the first down for the Big 8. Now they're finally getting something rolling. Number 31, Johnny Lynn, made the stop for the Pac 10. He's from UCLA.
Lynn and I were talking about that before the game. We wanted to see if Tom Lott could run out of the backfield. Everybody knows that he can run as a quarterback, but maybe it takes a different perspective when you're back there looking at what you're going to run. But Thomas Lott just picked up a nice gain on that one. He can run with the football.
Well, we didn't know whether he could take a handoff. We knew he could give the handoff. I didn't know whether he could take it or not. Uh-oh, there's a mix-up on the play. Tom Sorley does not want it, particularly after getting nailed. A mix-up in the back, but it looked like he didn't reach the fullback, and the fullback was number 21, Mike Kozlowski. So in a game like this, anything can happen. Number 95, and I got to do it sometime, I guess. Manu Tuiasosopo.
Tuiasosopo.
Tuiasosopo was involved in the tackle, along with middle linebacker number 45, Bruce Beakley.
Second and 10.
Looks like they're in a passing formation with both backs split. Sorley's back. Looking deep. Nobody open. I didn't think so because he was going for number 28, Ray Hardy, and looked like that he was going to be pushed out of bounds by the defensive back. And defensive backs here, as opposed to pro football with the five-yard chuck rule, can hit the receivers downfield.
We might talk about some of the rules that are in effect. It's sort of a game that's after the college season, but they're kicking off from the 35-yard line. The college rule does apply for catching the ball. You only have to have 1 foot in bounds. There is only a one-point conversion. You cannot go for 2 points. A couple of other minor changes or rules that we'll relate to as the evening goes on.
There's number 28, Ray Hardy from Iowa State. Good protection. And he was going to him, but he was all covered by number 22, Kim Anderson, who has outstanding speed.
Here's a look at the receiver, Ray Hardy, the wide receiver from Iowa State. Going to see him on his pass route, and you're going to see pretty fine coverage back here defensively by number 22, closing on him right there real good. He'd made his drop, a proper drop, and came right at the ball just as it was delivered.
Did a good job of not putting his hands on him too, Don. Interference call could have been called. Fourth down, they're in punting formation. High snap, Billy Todd gets it off. Fair catch by Anderson on about the 17-yard line. We're at the Kingdome, we're at Challenge Bowl 2, and we're going to return with more action from the Kingdome after these messages.
It's so wonderful to make a child's dream come true. It's a moment of love, a joyous sensation. Pepsi way. Come on, come on, and have a Pepsi day.
I've seen what the new cars have to sell, but I'm not sold. Toyota, what have you got?
The Celica Experience, the 1979 Toyota Celica GT liftback.
You got it.
The beauty of a dynamic 2.2-liter engine.
You got it.
The beauty of a smooth silk 5-speed overdrive transmission.
Toyota, you have got it.
You ask for it, you got it, Toyota.
There he is, John McKay, and what a fantastic record he had at
University of Southern California, doing an outstanding job now with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Quick throw, oh, slant over the middle, and Thompson had his man wide open. That was number 24, Calvin Sweeney. He had an opportunity to catch it to Don, but he couldn't come up. He just must have lost his concentration. As you can see, he's going back to the huddle. He's explaining, that's all my fault.
Say, look, guys, I'm sorry. You know, timing can be a factor, but it was not a factor on that when Thompson did get the ball to Sweeney, and Sweeney should have been able to make that catch. A couple of other rules that are in effect here. Defensive team cannot blitz, nor can they have any zone coverage in the secondary.
And I'm sure that Thompson would say no tackling the quarterback, too. James Owens up the middle, not much there, maybe a couple of yards. Tackle looked like by the middle of the Big 8 defensive line. Do not let him get in the open, though, because that's what the Big 8 is saying, because if he does, it's all over.
Well, he took sixth place in the Olympic Games in the hurdles in 1976. He's got 4.9 speed. Caught seven TD passes also, James Owens did, for UCLA this year.
They got Phil Francis, 37, from Stanford in the ballgame now. He's an excellent pass receiver. Screen pass. Owens, he's got a block. He's got some room. Showing outstanding running ability, taking for first down up around the 38 or 39-yard line of the Pac-10.
Well, that's the guy we just talked about. We said he was quite a hurdler in the 76 Olympic Games. Here you see him taking that screen pass. He's getting a nice block for number 82, Ron Beyer, up there in front of him. Now Owens just does his number. Look at that move that he puts right there, breaking to the outside. Severin Reese is downfield trying to throw a block, but Owens doesn't need too much help.
They figure they've got to throw on this football team, particularly with Thompson at quarterback. Quick out. Reese, about an 8-yard gain. Now, if they're going to lay off those receivers, Don, you know what that throwing Simone is going to do. He's going to put it out in the flat.
And one of the things you have to do, you have to give the receivers a little room because they've got so much speed, this Pac-10 group does. We're looking at number 1, Severin Reese there, going back to the huddle.
What are a lot of the pro scouts? And there's a man that's a legend from Oklahoma, formerly of Oklahoma, now the St. Louis Cardinals. And what a job he did of turning the St. Louis Cardinals around after losing 8 in a row. Up top, could be intercepted. It is picked off. Number 33, Tom Perticone from Iowa State, coming up with a tipped ball. A big break for the Big 8.
Here's a look at it again, Len. Actually, the quarterback, Thompson, was pretty much right on with this. When you're going to see Ron Beyer, it was just a little bit high, went off of his fingertips. He kept it up in the air long enough for Perticone to get to it. Tom Perticone coming down with the turnover from Iowa State. There he is on the sidelines. He did his job well.
Now it's up to the Big 8. Up the middle. Rogers the ball carrier, and it was number 95, Mano Tuiasosopo, coming up with a tackle. We now have 9 minutes, almost 37 seconds remaining. The score is the Pac-10 7, the Big 8 nothing. 5-yard run by James Owens, coming up with a touchdown. Two running backs in there. Number 88, Jerry Wilkerson, big, tall defensive lineman coming in to knock it down, but his arm was going forward. He was in the motion of throwing.
Let's take a look at it again. There's the quarterback, Sorley, from Nebraska. Number 88, Jerry Wilkerson, right there. You see 88 get his hand on him. Wilkerson's a defensive lineman from Oregon State.
He's, 6'9 or 6'10. The advantage there of a big defensive end is he was actually blocked but got his hand back in there. Well, we got a split backfield, which indicates most of the time a passing situation. People are moving out there. The whistles are being blown, and the yellow flag is thrown.
I'm going to speculate up here. It looked like Jerry Wilkerson, number 88, was moving prematurely, but let's see. Now we're going to see that the infraction, the ruling does go against the Big 8. Let's look at the bottom of the screen here. We're going to see some movement there. Okay, there we got it. Number 63, Sam Clappin, moving prematurely for the Big 8.
You thought that Wilkerson was very, very quick.
Yeah. And he's back there in a hurry. He's taking a look at that tackle. They're going to have to throw the football now or do something with it. Either a draw. Going deep. He's got a man open. It's a big, tall, tight end, number 88 guy, Preston. Out of Iowa State, but he is well short. The first down, it was 45. Middle linebacker Bruce Beakley coming up with a stop. Foot help from 96, Kyle Heinrich. And that name is familiar. There's the big tight end. All right, we're going to take a look at the deep men back there. Number 22 is Kim Anderson. He's the man that they want to get the ball to. Big, high lobby kick. Fair catch called for at the 25-yard line. So let's pause briefly. More action in just 60 seconds.
I can tell by the happy mood you're in, by that ever-widening grin. There's good news on your face, and it comes from only one place. You look like you just heard from Team Winner. I see that smile is growing bigger and bigger. You look like you just heard.
It takes a lot to make an investor happy today, but at Dean Witter, with our investment services, our research, and above all, our people, we think we can make you happy too.
You look like you just heard from Dean Witter. You look like you just heard from Dean
Tennis returns to the Mizlou Television Network in April with the Jack Benny Memorial Tennis Classic from Houston, Texas. This will benefit the Juvenile Diabetes Foundation. World Tennis Classics right here on the Mizlou Television Network.
Don, we haven't talked about the people who do the work up there, and that's the offensive line. And I'm going to get to who's out there right after this play. Number 14, Jack Thompson. Back to throw once again. Quick out. He's got his man Reese. Step very close to the first down. I do think he does have a first down.
Awful close. Gary Irons made the tackle, the defensive back from Oklahoma State, as we look at Severin Reese, who caught that pass from Jack Thompson.
First down, 8 minutes, 35 seconds remaining. First quarter, it's the Pac-10 leading the Big 8 by the score of 7-0. There's a defensive unit out there. We take a look at number 77, Ken Vangarda from Missouri, 76. Frank King, University of Kansas. Ron Suda, 86, from Missouri. Phil Tabor, 74, from Oklahoma. That's the defensive front four. Another pass, looking for a slant in. He's got his man. Number one, Reese, caught it in the crowd. Outstanding throw and an outstanding catch.
Well, I tell you what, Len, that's pretty good timing. Quarterback Thompson and Severin Reese connecting up that time. Good defense that time by Gary Irons, number three. Let's take a look at it again. Good rangy defensive back. He's 6'4", 191 from Oklahoma State. Doing his back right there, back pedal. Now he has to close on Reese and gets up in time, but good timing on it, but he gave him just a little bit too much room. Pack 8, Pack 10, picked up another first and 10.
Big fullback, the Otis Brown, getting a couple of yards. I was talking about that offensive line. Number 70, the left tackle, Roger Westland from Washington. Number 66, the left guard, Tom Larson from Washington State. The center is number 77, Mark Chandlis from Washington State. And number 50, George Yarno from Washington State is playing right guard, but he also plays defense, played defense all year, so he's had to make a switch. The right tackle, number 75, Bruce Davis from UCLA. They are the men that must protect number 14, Jack Thompson. Trying to go over the middle, but a good play by the linebacker. Number 67, Chris Garlich from University of Missouri and also from where I reside, Kansas City, Missouri. Went to Rockhurst High School. That I know.
There's head coach John McKay from the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. What a record he came up with out there at USC. Fantastic job.
There's old gimpy-kneed Bill Nelson, too. He used to play for John McKay at USC. I was talking to him prior to the ball game, Don. He said, say hello. Oh, wide open.
down the middle. 37, Phil Francis out of Stanford. Let's take a look at Thompson again. He shows that he is an excellent quarterback. Just a fantastic career. Good quick release there. Phil Francis coming out of the backfield. Francis from Stanford had injury problems quite a bit, but he came on strong late in the year. Fine running back and a fine receiver.
I'll tell you, he might have given number 33, Tom Perdicone, a headache when he lowered his headgear on that one. I formation. Pitch out. Speedster Owens, nothing doing out there. Fine defensive play by the right side of that defensive line, in particular number 69 for...
69 would be Chester Jeffrey. Number 57 also, Lynn, was right in there. Jeff Lee, who did a good job. Jeff Lee from Colorado and Chester Jeffrey from Kansas State.
Second and 10 at 30.
You can tell that this young man came to throw the football to show the people what he could do, and he's going to do it once again. Sideline pattern might be intercepted. It is. Number 17, Mike Clemens of Iowa State, coming up with a big turnover for the Big 8.
I tell you what, Clemens was in excellent position on that. Let's look at the throw in Samoan. Jack Thompson there, he's trying to hit number 24, Cal Sweeney, who does the sideline route there, but number 17, Clemens, plays it just right. You got to lay off that receiver and move back when you've got the ball in the air. Clemens did an excellent job from Iowa State and came off with the interception.
He was looking for that play.
Oh, yeah.
All right, Big 8 now on the march. It's going to be a quick slanting pass. See, that was number 24, Charlie Green out of K-State. Looked like he had an opportunity to come up with that football. Let's take a look at the offensive line for the Big 8. Number 73, left tackle, Kelvin Clark from Nebraska. Number 56, Barney Cotton from Nebraska. Number 60 is Dave Monroe, Oklahoma State. 61, Dave Griffin, Colorado. 63, Sam Clappin from Oklahoma. Thomas Lott, number 6, on a draw play.
Lynn, I think one reason that the passing attack is not that good for the Big 8 as it is for the Pac-10 is the Pac-10 is a much more wide-open conference. They throw the ball a lot more. In the Big 8, they do a lot of that wishbone kind of stuff, and they keep the ball on the ground a great deal. Most of those ball clubs do.
Well, with the exception, I think, of K-State and Nebraska. Minucci is also here. He's the quarterback out of K-State that had a fine year last year. We're going to find out. Sorley's back to throw. Good throw, good catch. Big tight end number 88, Guy Preston from Iowa State. Say, big guy, he's about 6'7".
A lot of pressure put on the quarterback, Sorley. Let's watch him. Quarterback Tom Sorley from Nebraska. All Big 8. You're gonna see from the right side of your screen, you're gonna see someone almost blindside him right there. He gets away, gets the ball off just in time. Well, you have to feel it out there. You can't always see those defenders coming in. This time he felt it and got Guy Preston downfield for a nice game.
Yeah, they feel it all right. We got 5 minutes remaining in the first period, and the score is Pac-10 7, Big 8 nothing. Tom Sorley, number 12, quarterback from Nebraska. Guiding the tack, fourth down, they're going to go for it. Straight ahead, up and over. Whoa, was he met. Middle of that line, number 5, Mandu Tuya Sotopo was one. Number 45, Bruce Beakley, middle linebacker from Oregon, was another meeting him. Mike Kozlowski, number 21, the fullback, was attempting to come up with it. Look at that. You can look at John McKay's pointing in one direction and the Big 8's pointing in the other.
Not even close enough where you have to have a measurement. Good stop that time by the Pac-10. They're going to be in excellent field position.
4 minutes, 43 seconds to go, 10 or 7 nothing. We'll be back with more action in a moment.
Attention Track 2 users, attention Aptra users. Get ready for really clean shaving. Introducing Ultrex from Schick Super 2. The only twin blades with one push cleaning. Watch, one push pushes out soap and stubble for a clean start on really close shaves. Look, Ultrex slides on Track 2 razors, clicks on Actra razors. Get new Ultrex with one push cleaning. Only Schick Super 2 Ultrex has one push cleaning.
At a time like this, you probably don't care that we use only personally selected hops, or choice barley malt, or pure artesian brewing water. But you'd taste the difference if we didn't. So we do. Olympia. It's a water and a lot
more. We're back at the Kingdome. The score is the Pac-10 7, the Big 8 nothing, and the Pac-10 with the ball. They have a man that can throw it at the helm, number 14, Jack Thompson. He loves to throw. He's going to do it again. He's going deep. He's got a man wide, wide open. It's Reese. He's there. He's got it, but he steps out of bounds about the three-yard line. Oh, and he says, why did I do that? But it was a fine throw and a real fine move by number one, Severn Reese. Well, I tell you what, everything worked well for the Pac-10 on this one. Little play action there. You fake to a man going into the line. It gave Thompson a little bit more time to throw. He's got a lot of time back there. And Severn Reese just does a beautiful job downfield. He's all by himself by 5 yards. Doesn't see the sidelines there, or he could have cut back in maybe, but a fine grab inside the 5-yard line for the Pac-10.
Well, you can hardly get more open than that. He must have had his man beat by some 7 or 8 yards.
All right, we're looking now. We've got double tight in the ball game now. Two tight ends, 82 Ron Beyer, 81 Lamar Lundy. Indication that they're going to go for it. He's going to throw the ball. He wide open. Touchdown, number 24, Calvin Sweeney. And you can imagine how happy number 3, James Owens, is.
Well, I tell you what, you like to see that in an all-star game. Wide open football. James Owens taking the pitch there. Doesn't really fool May here. I can tell he's going to throw all the way he's going, but he jumps like a basketball player. He's doing a jump shot there, throws it to Cal Sweeney, who's got behind the defender there. Fine play there for the Pac-10.
He'll be talking about that, Don. You backs will get an opportunity to throw the ball and complete it in the end zone. That's the only thing that he'll remember about this ball game, probably.
He'll remember it for a lifetime.
We've got the kicker in, Paul Watson. He was successful the last time that he attempted an extra point. Uh-oh, not this time. Not this time. No good. Pac-10 leading by the score now of 13 to nothing.
And Paul Watson just drilled that extra point attempt right into the goalpost. But the Pac-10 off here and roaring in the first quarter of this game at the Kingdome.
I didn't notice if he had a tee or not. Of course, in college, they're permitted to use a tee, but in professional football, they are not permitted to use a tee. Notice down there on the goal line, I mentioned two tight ends in the ball game, and you can do that when you get inside the 5-yard line, because inside the 5-yard line, the opposing team can get into a short yardage situation. Otherwise, there is no short yardage situation. The linebackers cannot blitz.
Mizlou will again cover the National Invitational Tournament, one of college basketball's most exciting postseason events, on many of these Mizlou stations. It'll be prime time on Wednesday night, March 21st. That's the NIT right here on Mizlou.
Well, we've got number 34, Jimmy Rogers, number 24, Charles Green, back to try to field this punt, try to get something going for the Big 8. Rogers at the 20. Not much there. Being drawn down at about the 25-yard line. Looked like number 31, Johnny Lynn, defensive safety man, coming up with the stop. The passing game, you can see, has been very beneficial to the Pac-10, because you can get together, I think, Don, a passing game a lot quicker than you can a running game.
It takes a lot more timing, which means you need a lot more time.
We're going to find out. Back to throw to the big tight end. He hits him in the stomach, but he doesn't come up with the ball. Number 88, Guy Preston, had an opportunity to catch that one, but he didn't come up with it. We've got 4 minutes, 22 seconds remaining in this ball game. The Pac-10 out in front, or in the ball game, in the first quarter. Pac-10 leading by the score of 13 to nothing. They're going to have to go to the air. They're going to have to start finding some kind of passing game to get things moving.
Oh, yes. Number 21, Mike Kozlowski, probably will agree with me on that, Don, because he really took his shot from the middle linebacker, number 45, Bruce Beakley, and he's been doing an outstanding job so far.
And the Big 8 has been fairly successful in getting pass receivers open, Len. They just haven't been able to hang on to the ball like the Pac-10 receivers have. So they've had the ball in the air, not near as much, of course, as the Pac-10, but those that they've had out there should have been caught and were not. We're looking at number 53, Gary Cobb there, linebacker from USC.
Going to go deep, wants to go up top. Number 24 is Green. He's got it. Great throw and great catch. Yes, sir. Number 24 from K-State, Charlie Green.
Well, we talked about Kim Anderson, number 22, the defensive back, doing a great job earlier. There's Anderson, number 22 right now. This time the quarterback, Tom Sorley, though, burns him a little bit. Number 24 is Charlie Green. There, right there. He knows he's beaten. He stumbles a little bit. That doesn't help his cause any. And number 24 is Charlie Green getting behind him. Anderson recovering, but too little too late.
Well, I'll tell you, that was great concentration by Charlie Green. He watched that ball all the way. Back again. Sorley wants some more.
Looking deep. He's got a man over the middle. Does he have it?
Yes.
Yes, sir. Number 28, Ray Hardillo. An outstanding catch. About 2 inches off the floor of the Kingdome.
I tell you what, he went down with like a first baseman on this one, scooping it off the turf there. But before it hit the ground, let's take a look at it again. Number 12, Tom Sorley, throwing a little bit low to Ray Hardy right there. Hardy goes down. One of the rules that's applying this game, unless someone touches you when you go down, you can get up and run. That's a pro rule. In college ball, once the knee hits the ground, you have to stay down.
Big 8 in scoring territory right now. Into the end zone, number 21, Mike Kozlowski out of Colorado. And the Big 8 gets on the board.
Boy, the guys up front did a beautiful job on that one. Kozlowski went in there almost untouched. A fine run by Kozlowski, but an excellent blocking that time by the Big 8 offensive line.
They take the right side of that Big 8 line, 63, Sam Clappin, 61, Dave Griffin, 60, the center, Dave Monroe. Left guard is 56, Barney Cotton. 73, left tackle is Kelvin Clark from Nebraska. When you open holes like that, well, I would say you can run through those holes, because you could run through any holes, but I could have run through that.
We could get down there and do it, Len.
Billy Todd trying to make it 7. It's up. It's good. 13-7 now. Big 8 getting back in the ball game. Made it look easy. The big play, of course, was that pass from Sorley to Charlie Green, K-State, coming up with that big play. And that was a fine throw. I think a lot of pro scouts are trying to figure out the arm of Sorley. I've heard them say, well, can he throw the deep ball?
Well, Tom Sorley certainly can. He's the number one passer. We're looking at Bud Wilkins in there, the head coach of the St. Louis Cardinals, and, of course, the legendary coach from the University of Oklahoma.
I remember he had 47 wins in a row at Oklahoma. That's the longest in college football history. And he's had a fantastic career at Oklahoma, and as I said, he's done a great job of turning around the St. Louis Cardinals after losing 8 in a row. So now we've got a score of 2 minutes 58 seconds remaining, first quarter. Pac-10 13, Big 8 7. Taking a look at the deep end for Billy Todd will approach the ball at the 35-yard line, not the 40 like it is in college football. A high hanging kick. Taken by James Owen. It's going to the outside. They don't want him outside and loose. And he's brought down by number 67, Chris Garlick, middle linebacker of University of Missouri. It's a good thing he was there.
Let's take a look at this again. This guy just explodes. You're going to see him break to the outside there. He hasn't really turned it on yet. Get some good blocking over there. And watch it right there. He just explodes down that sideline. Number 67, Chris Garlick, had to bring him down, but Owens can fly.
Thompson wants it right back. Over to Reese. Giving him a lot of room over there. I think one of the problems with the defensive backs, and in particular the things that I've heard about number three, Gary Irons, is he's a rangy player. He seems more designed for a safety than a cornerback because I think his speed is somewhere in the area of 4.8, 4.9. And when you're playing cornerback, when you're going against somebody that runs a 4.5, 40, then you got to give them a lot of room. And when you do that and you got a quarterback like Thompson who can fire it out in the flat, you're in trouble.
You got to have great quickness out in that corner slot. And Irons, as you mentioned already, Len, just doesn't have.
But they have a great pass rush. That's what he's hoping for. Straight up the middle. Number 37. Bill Francis from Stanford picking up about 4 or 5 yards.
And Francis is a big one. He's a big running back who had some injuries. Let's take a look at Chris Garlick, number 67, the middle linebacker. There's a lot of traffic in the middle of that area there. Right there, he takes a lick. He's got to keep his position, though. He does keep his feet. Gets onto the ball carrier. It's awful congested in there. Tough job, good job done by Chris Garlick, though.
He's more designed as an outside linebacker. He only weighs about 215. Straight ahead, the big fullback. The Otis Brown, number 27 from UCLA. 2 minutes, 13 seconds remaining in this quarter, and the score is the Pac-10 13, the Big 8 7, with the Pac-10 on the move.
Looking at number 27, Theotis Brown now going to the sidelines, running a lot of players in. That's Big Abe Gibran over there on the sidelines, isn't it?
Big Abe Gibran.
Okay. One of John McKay's assistants.
Oh, good catch, good throw, and keeping your feet in bounds by number one, Severin Reese. UCLA.
You know, this kid would have been an All-American had he been on a passing ball club, but UCLA's not necessarily a passing ball club. He caught 20 passes for 420 yards, a 22-yard average per catch. Boy, he just did an excellent job on this one. He's got great speed, great hands. Let's take a look at it again. You're going to see him really do a toe number there to keep his feet in bounds right there. And very easily could have gone out, but made a nice...
I don't know whether we explained or not. He only needs 1 foot inbounds because they're playing the college rules. This is a short yardage situation. Two tight ends in the ball game. Straight ahead, the big fullback, Theotis Brown, number 27, and he picks up the first down. Also, after a first down, we should tell him that's college rules too, Don, because they'll stop the clock and let them move the chain gang like they do in college football. As opposed to pro ball, they just continue it. Speaking of continuing, it's down around 1 minute 37 seconds. Left remaining in the first period with the Pac-10 on the move. They're getting that passing game moving, and with that passing game going, it's going to make that running game all the much better. Great balance by 27th Theotis Brown.
Gosh, what can you say about that? Bill Fisher, the defensive back from Kansas State, had Theotis Brown deep in the backfield, but Brown just did an excellent number there, pulling those feet up, continuing to keep his balance and gain good yardage on it.
Don, can you teach somebody that type of balance?
Well, you know, you talk to youngsters a lot and you tell them to pick up their feet, do these kinds of things, but that kind of thing has to be inherent. I don't think you can really teach it.
Coming up now, second down, 6 yards to go, 23-yard line for Jack Thompson, number 14, Washington State. Straight ahead, number 37, Phil Francis, picking up a couple of more yards. I wanted to put him in the Big 8. He's doing so well with K-State. He's from Washington State. Coming up now in about a 3rd-and-3 situation. This is a situation that you can throw or run on. And it wouldn't surprise me to see Mr. Thompson put the ball up in the air because he seems to like to do it very well, and he does it so very well. James Owen, Theotis Brown in the backfield. Good cutback by Theotis Brown. Good enough, I think, for a first down.
Boy, you got a fine block that time, too, by number 70, Roger Weston. Did an excellent job of blocking a man out so Theotis Brown could cut inside him for the necessary 1st and 10 yardage. We're looking at number 27, Theotis Brown, 6'3", 218, UCLA, hometown Oakland.
Instead of the tight end shuffling back and forth, they're shuffling back and forth with the plays, with the offensive backs. We've got Phil Francis, number 37, now in the ballgame, replacing Theotis Brown. And remember, he's an excellent pass receiver. And so is this man, number one, Reese,
once again throwing a quick out in front of number three, Gary Irons. He's giving him a lot of room, and you cannot do that with a fine quarterback like Jack Thompson.
Well, Severn Reese and Jack Thompson have found a home over on the right side of that big eight line, working on particularly Gary Irons, number three.
Two tight ends in the ball game now. We've got number 82, Von Beyer, Arizona, number 81, Lamar Lundy, as we have 6 seconds remaining in this first half.
Ready?
First quarter, I should say.
Good job, Jack. First down.
Well, you saw how much they made it by.
The ball they're playing with is not a collegiate ball. It's a Mr. Pete Rozelle ball, which is the National Football League ball. It is a little different than the collegiate ball that they use.
Len, I never really noticed the difference. I just was handed the ball. It really didn't make any difference. Could have been a grapefruit.
Well, if you're a quarterback and you make a mistake in throwing, you want some excuse to have.
Okay.
37, Phil Francis is in the ball game, along with number three, James Owen. Pass. A wide open number 82, Ron Beyer. Tight end coming across, and is he happy? Yes, he is. Completely faked out the defensive unit of the Big Eight. He had all the time in the world to throw the football.
Offensive line doing a good job for the Pac-10. That time, Jack Thompson with plenty of time to throw, look for his receiver, and if you give Thompson the time, he'll certainly find someone.
Shows one thing, that they're not afraid to put the ball up in the air or do anything at any stage of the game.
Hey, let's take a look at Thompson again here. Excellent quarterback. The throw on Samoan from Washington State. Right on the money. He looks like he's been working with these guys for a long time. That's Ron Beyer, tight end from Arizona.
If you have time to throw with the short yardage situation, you know you're going to get... you can go for the two-point rule down here, too, also. 1 second remaining in the first quarter, but they can go for two. Give it to the speedster, Lynn Kane. Did not make it. So they'll have to settle for 6 points. 1 second remaining on the clock in the first quarter. The score now is 19 for the Pac-10 and 7 for the Big 8. I was mentioning down close down there, they can play a zone defense or man-to-man. Those were the rules that they decided upon before the ball game. And you know when you get inside that 10-yard line, you know you're going to get man-to-man coverage. So they get the play-action passes, and if you have time to throw and have time to see, as you can see here, you have time to get people open.
Yeah, this is what you call having plenty of time to throw. A little play-action there. Fakes to a couple of men going back, but you're going to see the throw in Samoan. Jack Thompson there all in the screen by himself as he finds Ron Beyer. Beyer had plenty of time to get open. Thompson had plenty of time to find him.
Taking a look at the deep end, we'll be back for the Big Eight, number 24. Charles Green, 34. Ray Hartee, number 28, ordinarily back there, was 34, Jimmy Rogers, but Hardy, Iowa State, who led the Big 8 in returns, coming up with the kick and getting back to the 35-yard line. That's excellent position. Well, that's the end of the first quarter. It's the Big 10, 19, Big 8, 7. All right, now it's up to Tom Sorley once again to get this club moving. Thomas Lott, number six, found a hole. Coming up about 8 yards. Good hole, good blocking by that offensive line of the Big Eight. And if there's one strength that they felt perhaps that the Big Eight had over the Pac-10, it was the offensive line.
That's right. They got a big line from that Big Eight conference, and they thought they had an edge there. But, well, let's see what happens.
Wasn't any surprise, number 84, Jerry Robinson, the fine linebacker from UCLA, was around the ball. So was number 94, Ralph DeLoach. He's from Cal. Bootleg. Going for everything. Over everybody's head.
Ralph DeLoach that time put a lot of pressure on the quarterback. We got another quarterback in there now for the Big 8. It's Dan Minucci, quarterback from Kansas State, just came into the lineup, and he's already taken his lumps. That time he got dumped pretty good. Getting a look at him right there, number 88 is tight end Guy Preston from Iowa State.
Found out one thing, he could throw the ball fairly deep, though.
Yep, good arm.
This is a short yardage situation. They looked at, I looked for him to go for the first down to pick it up. Straight ahead, number 21, Mike Kozlowski from Colorado, picking up the first down. They'll stop the clock momentarily. Number 94, Ralph DeLoach, in on the stop, along with a man we've been talking about doing a great job at middle linebacker, number 45, Bruce Beakley. 190 tackles, 100 unassisted this past year. Bruce Beakley from Oregon. That's being around the football. Dan Minucci out of K-State. Looking for some help. Got him out of that man receiver of a screen pass. Mike Kozlowski, fine receiver, coming up with the catch. Coming up with the first down.
Kozlowski had some injury problems this year, but he's come along pretty well. Let's take a look at number 45, Bruce Beakley, the linebacker. Right there, he knows it's a pass. You see him doing his drop there. Now he knows it's a screen, and you can see him in hot pursuit. Let's see how close he gets to number 21, Kozlowski. Number 61 right there blows him away. That's Dave Griffin. Griffin doing a good job blocking on him. Number 21, Kozlowski picks up good yardage because of that block by Griffin.
I'll say one thing, number 45, Bruce Beakley, didn't stop after he got hit. He still went back, tried to get back in the play. Thomas Lott, not much there. Nothing doing, maybe a couple of yards before being tackled and also involved in the play. We just talked about the young man, number 45, Bruce Beakley, was involved in the play along with number 94, Ralph DeLoach. They want to get this man in the open field. They want to see what he can do because he can run with a football. Naturally, the Pac-10 says we don't want him in the open field. Got second down, about seven to go. Minucci back, quick out. Did not get it out to Bobby Kimball, number 22, a wide receiver from Oklahoma. Kim Anderson, number 22, defending East Arizona State. But the ball was not thrown very well. That's not the place to throw it, behind the receiver, particularly on a quick out, because that ball pops up in the air, and a man like Kim Anderson gets a hold of it. It's embarrassing trying to run him down on the sideline.
Nothing between him and that other goal line, but a lot of green.
Still have 7 yards to go, or six and a half. Still he's going to throw. He's fighting and scrambling for that first down. He may have it. It's very close. If they don't have it, I'm sure that they're going to go for it. Minucci has great running ability. He can run the 40-yard dash, you know, in about 4.6 or 4.7. Once again, 45, Bruce Beakley is around the ball. 54, linebacker Willie Blasher.
Good defense that time by the Pac-10. There's how much they need. You can see just a very little bit the Big 8 needs to convert on this fourth down situation.
Trailing 19-7, they've got to go for it. Pac-8 decides to take a timeout. We'll return with more action from the Kingdome after this timeout.
I've looked at a lot of different cars that are not so different. Toyota, what have you got?
The all-new Toyota Corona four-door sedan with a fifth door in the back.
You got it!
A luxurious new sedan with the flexibility of a liftback.
You got it!
The 79 Toyota Corona liftback, the different sedan.
Toyota, you've got it.
You ask for it, you got it, Toyota.
I can tell by the happy mood you're in, by that ever-widening grin. You look like you just heard from Dean Witter.
At Dean Witter, your investment program is designed around you and no one else, so you can't help smiling when you hear from us.
You look like you just heard from Dean Witter.
college basketball's number one All-Star game right here on Mizlou Television, Friday night, March 23rd, the Coach's East-West All-Star game. Check the time for in your area.
Double tight formation, fourth and just inches to go. They've got to come up with it. Up and over, number 21, Mike Kozlowski. Did he make it? Abe Gibron has coached both offense and defense. He's coaching the offensive line for John McKay in Tampa.
Boy, Bruce Beakley just did an excellent job on that one. Number 21, Kozlowski, was going over the top or attempting to go over the top, and Beakley met him right in the pass.
Going over what they thought was the strength over the right side, the strength of that offensive line. All right, we got a new quarterback. Number 11, Charlie Young, out of Cal, University of California. Delayed play. Number 3, James Owen, finds a little running room, picks up about 7 or 8 yards. It's an interesting case with Charlie Young. He played defense this past year. All of his quarterbacking was done a year ago in 1977. So I guess what happens if there's a fumble or an interception, he can tackle somebody.
Well, let's see if he can still throw the football after a year off.
I was watching him. He can still throw it. Number 1, Reese. Having an outstanding evening so far. Owen. First down. Nothing there, but he found some little room to pick up about 4 or 5 yards. He doesn't run like the sprinters that you ordinarily think would run with straight ahead without the lateral mobility. What's your opinion of him?
He's so smooth, but when he gets into a heavy traffic, he can do those little choppy numbers to get himself open. But I like to watch him run in the open field because he looks so graceful and powerful, can really accelerate.
He looks like I would like to look. First down. Oh, big hole for fullback number 27, Theodis Brown. And when he gets a hole, 236 or 40 pounds of him, he's going to move, picking up a first down.
Tom Perticone brought him down there. Tom Perticone brought him down there, but I think Perticone got the brunt of the blow on that when he gets sent back about 3 yards after he hit number 27, Theodis Brown.
Taking a look at the defense, who they just permitted the holes to open up on the last hole. You got to do something to put pressure on the quarterback and stop the fine running backs. And they did at that time. Very outstanding pursuit. The ball is loose. Big 8 has it. Take a look at who has it on the bottom of the pile. Looks like number 69, Chester Jeffery from K-State, coming up with a big turnover for the Big 8.
A lot of pursuit that time by the Big 8. James Owens found himself in a lot of traffic out there. Jeffery coming up with the fumble recovery. Here's a look at it again. The new quarterback, Charlie Young, got a little pitchback number there to James Owens, number 3. Now, you see, Owens can't get wide, and there's that good pursuit that I mentioned by the Big 8, and there's the fumble recover by Jeffery.
Quick screen out to Charlie Green, and I don't know how Hoochie got the ball out there. He had to throw it under the arms of a defensive lineman out there. But whatever he did, it worked because it picked up a first down. It'll stop the clock momentarily with 10:30 remaining in the first half. The score is Pac-10-19, the Big 8-7. Number 88, Jerry Wilkerson. Number 92, Rich Dimmler. They were involved in the stop.
Number 22, Bobby Kimball there came and whispered to Dan Minucci, bringing in a play from the sideline. Coach Bud Wilkinson.
Taking a look at number 22, Bobby Kimball. Out of Oklahoma. Look out, not this time. Number 88, Jerry Wilkerson. Big 6'9", 250-some pound, the defensive end from Oregon State. He was not fooled one bit on that bootleg.
Came off the line in a hurry for a guy that's stretched out 6'9", and carrying 263 pounds. We're looking at him there. Gosh, he really looks lean, but 269 pounds on the 6'9 frame.
Well, he'll give quarterbacks fits, just the simple fact that he can stretch his arms out
when he
fills out, Len, he can weigh 320 pounds.
He can weigh whatever he wants to, I believe. Nucci back to throw, looking for somebody. He's got his man open, but he overthrew him. Number 21, Mike Kozlowski. I think he hurried that throw just a little bit, and you can see that he feels the same way. The one on the right is John McKay. The one on the left is Bill Nelson. Bill played for John down at USC. Of course, Bill had a great career. Pittsburgh and Cleveland. John McKay had a tremendous coaching career at USC. Nucci back to throw. Look out, he's being pressured. Number 94, Ralph DeLoach. That's the best pass defense in the world. Got to put pressure on him. Quarterback Dan Minucci this time dropping back. You're going to see the pressure right there put on by number 94, big Ralph DeLoach from Cal. 6'5", 255. Minucci cannot get away from him.
They are not blitzing either, so that means the defensive front four are going to have to do it themselves.
Take a look at the deep man. Number 22 is Kim Anderson back to receive the kick.
There won't be any rush on the punter. That's not...
Oh, look out. Oh, great stop by Billy Todd. Fair catch. Kim Anderson.
Great catch by Billy Todd back there.
Put him in a receiver. All right, we're at the Kingdome. Let's pause 60 seconds for these messages from your local stations.
Instead of paying carpenters, plumbers, and electricians for work you can do yourself, you can save money on home repairs and get a free gift for watching this commercial. Look for this announcement in your Sunday paper. It introduces Home Repair and Improvement from Time Life Books. Expert ideas to help make your home more beautiful, more fun to live in, maybe even more valuable. With this reply card, you can get the first volume to examine for 15 days free. But what only you will know, because you're watching now, is how to get this sturdy canvas handyman's apron worth $2 absolutely free. This S on the reply card stands for Home Repair Savings. When you send for volume one, turn the S into a dollar sign, and we'll send you a handyman's apron free. So look for this announcement in your Sunday paper. Turn the S into a dollar sign and get a handyman's apron as a gift from Time Life Books.
But I don't think he's too concerned at the moment. There's 8:40 remaining in the first half. Well, I see a couple of yellow flags, and we've only had one penalty prior to this last occasion. Yellow flag is down. This is the second penalty of the afternoon, or the evening, I should say. Going to be against the Pac-10, and a decision for the Big Eight. No, sir. Illegal procedure declined. It's going to make it second down and some 12 yards to go on that last tackle. We had Frank King, number 76, from the University of Kansas. He's the only man out here, Don, that's played both ways for his college this past year.
Offensive guard and nose guard defensively.
Look out, look out. What was that? Charles Young throwing ball intended for number one, Severin Reese, but taking a look at the 77 statistics of this man, number 11, Charlie Young. 249 attempts, 135 completions, 54.2 percentage, and 1,875 yards, so he was able to throw, but he hadn't thrown in a year. And you know, when you're playing defensive back and beating up and knocking people down, it's tough.
The long layoff showed on that one, Lynn. Charlie Young looked a little bit rusty. Of course, he had a little pressure, too.
Number 14, Thompson back in the ball game, and he's going to do what he does best. He better get rid of it, and he does. He's got a man open. Sweeney, number 24, Calvin Sweeney, and it's Jack Thompson. He just got it off in time because he was getting a lot of pressure from the backside.
Well, Jack Thompson looking for his receiver right there, Cal Sweeney. Let's watch his pass route. He's looking inside right there. He's going to break in. He's already forced a defender, number 17, Clemens, back, breaks inside, and number 14, Thompson, was right on target with it.
Well,
Not much room. A couple of yards for number 27, fullback Theotis Brown out of UCLA. They really like him. The scouts that I've talked to, he has the size 6'3", 235, 236. He has the speed that he can run around a 4'6", 40, which is moving along pretty good. And an excellent blocker.
Not only that, he demonstrates a lot of quickness out here. Speed is one thing, but if you're quick on the football field, it's even more advantageous.
I formation. Reverse. Sweeney. Thompson gets a block of sorts, I say. There it is, number 31 is William Fisher coming up with a tackle. He was not fooled at all. Number 24, Calvin Sweeney with extreme speed, University of Southern Cal.
Got hemmed in that time, had no place to go, and Fisher had it well diagnosed. Aha, Mizlou, awesome with Dawson. Lenny's good to work with you.
Thank you. This is my first time doing play-by-play, in case you didn't notice. Things are going to get better, though, folks. Jack Thompson, quarterback, I formation. Play pass. Looking for Sweeney's, got him. Across the middle, a great move and a great throw and a great catch. And that is what the people down here are observing these young men. That is what they're looking for.
Well, you know, Thompson from Washington State and Sweeney from USC, they haven't worked together at all, just a few days. But watch this quick release by Jack Thompson. Little play action there. Now he's got his man spotted. He feels the pressure. And he's right on the money to Sweeney. Oh, he's quite a thrower, and that Sweeney can get open.
Straight ahead, number 37, Phil Francis from Stanford, picking up a couple of yards. So it'll be second down, about 7 yards to go. Looking at the ball now, approximately on the 28-yard line of the Big Eight. 6 minutes, 13, 12 seconds counting down in the first half. 19-7, Pac-8 leading the Big Eight. I formation. Play pass. Slant. Got his man, Sweeney, once again. Oh, yes.
What a combination.
Yes, sir.
You know, Len, it looks like they just waste two or three plays by running into the line, and then when they need the necessary yardage, Thompson drops back and finds Sweeney, who always seems to manage to get open. Number 24 right there, Cal Sweeney, wide receiver from USC.
One of the problems defensively is the fact that most of the time during the collegiate career of these defensive backs, they are not playing man-to-man. And brother, this is tough duty, particularly down here. They've got to play man-to-man all over the field. Owens, not much, a couple of yards. Number 3, James Owens, UCLA. He's got great speed, but they've done a good job most of the evening containing that great speed, not letting him get into the secondary. Well, we've got number 21, Lynn Kane, in the ball game. And number 3, James Owens, in the backfield. But look for number 14, this man, to go back and do something with the ball, like throwing it. Draw play, 21, Kane.
Number 74, Phil Tabor, making the stop on that one. Number 18, also in there, is Mike Edwards. Number 21, you're looking at going back to the huddle. Lynn Kane, the running back from USC.
Shuffling in the backs. Theodis Brown coming in now into bring in the play. Kane out. The coach, McKay, is calling the plays from the sidelines. And the staff for the Big Eight, they are also calling all the plays. Well, we got a timeout on the field. We'll return with more Challenge Bowl number 2 action after this timeout.
At a time like this, you probably don't care that we use only personally selected hops or choice barley malt or pure artesian brewing water. But you'd taste the difference if we didn't, so we do. Olympia. It's the water and a lot more.
Oh!
I've compared all the new cars but one. Toyota, what do you got?
The Toyota Celica GT Liftback, still a car of the 80s. Aerodynamically designed for better performance, surer stability. The new Celica, it puts the fun of driving back in style.
Toyota, you've got it.
You asked for it.
You got it, Toyota.
You know, fans, at halftime, you'll meet the 1978 PepsiCo Little All-America football team. Some of college football's most exciting players. That's coming up at halftime.
Coming up right now is the Pac-10. Resting in the area of the 10-yard line. It's third down. Bouncing back to throw. He's going up over top. Out of bounds. Number 24, Calvin Sweeney, the man that he's been so successful.
Let's take a look at it again. Thompson obviously had the right idea. He's been right with Sweeney all the time. Sweeney there turning inside, then going down, working on Mike Clemens. Really had Clemens beat, but the pass was just a little tall.
Now he's running out of real estate, too. Also, he didn't get his head turned around to really convince that defensive back that he was going to go to the outside. Well, we've got Paul Watson, his first field goal attempt. It is up. It is hooking. It is good. So, right now, the Pac-10 leading 22-7, and we'll be right back with more action after this timeout.
Vic Kamarchek only uses Head and Shoulders once in a while because he thinks it's harsh. We're going to prove it's gentle.
It feels like this, I can tell you.
Why don't you do this every day?
No, I don't.
For 4 days, one side of that hair was shampooed with the leading baby shampoo, the other side with Head and Shoulders, the shampoo that's unbeatable for controlling dandruff.
Is there a difference between the sides?
I can't feel the difference.
One side was washed with dandruff shampoo, the other with the leading baby shampoo.
What's the matter?
Okay, I remember. And then I asked you, what about the difference?
I didn't feel a difference.
That's it? A dandruff shampoo that's as gentle to hair and leaves it as soft as the leading baby shampoo. Here it is.
Head and Shoulders.
Victor, do you use Head and Shoulders?
Periodically.
Is it harsh?
It's a very mild product.
How are you going to use Head and Shoulders now? Is it going to... I just want to know.
Literally every night.
Head and Shoulders, the dandruff shampoo that babies your hair.
Tennis returns to Mizlou TV in April with the Jack Benny Memorial Classic from Houston, Texas. This will benefit the Juvenile Diabetes Foundation. World Tennis Classics right here on the Mizlou Television Network.
The deep backs, number 28, Ray Hardee, number 24, Charlie Green, trying to get something going. To the bottom of your screen was 28, Ray Hardee. They haven't had much of anything really so far. There's going to be Paul Watson kicking off much in returns, and you wouldn't expect it because these men are down here are the stars of the team in college, and they're generally not involved. They may not have to worry, but he's going to bring it out. About 2 yards deep in the end zone. Gets it out to about the 22-yard line. Number 82, Ron Beyer, tight end, was down there involved in the tackle. So, K-State quarterback Dan Minucci, number 10, will be at the helm right now. He's got 4 minutes, 45 seconds remaining in this first half to get something on the board. They need it because they're trailing the Pac-10 by the score of 22-7. Going back to throw. Going up top, going deep. Intercepted. Number 22 is Kim Anderson coming up with the interception. They were going for number 24, Charlie Green. The ball was slightly underthrown, but you must give credit to Anderson, who did a great job.
Anderson's been burned earlier, but this time you're going to say he's in excellent position on number 24, the intended receiver, Charlie Green, playing the ball real well and comes down with the interception for the Pac-10.
You know, I was talking to Bill Nelson during the week, about these defensive backs that they have, and he said we hardly complete any passes on these defensive backs. We've been trying to hide them, tell the scouts that they aren't any good. That man, he led the Pac-10 interceptions with 7 this past year. Play pass. Guess who he's trying to go to? Great catch, but he didn't hold on, I don't believe. No, sir. Calvin Sweeney, number 24. That would have been really a tremendous reception had he come up with it. Let's take a look at it again from the ground level. We're going to see that quarterback Charlie Young can throw the football. He's right on the money to Cal Sweeney, but you're going to see Sweeney take quite a lick there from Mike Edwards. Right there, you see, well, you just caught the tail end of it, but that would have been a great catch had Sweeney been able to hang on.
I'm sure he's saying right now, Charlie, please throw it a little lower so I don't have to go up so high. It hurts up here. Straight ahead, number 37, Phil Francis from Stanford. Just a couple of yards. So they're now in third down situation. They are now in a passing situation. Number 81, Lamar Lundy, Jr., coming into the huddle with the play from the sidelines. If he's smart, he had called his number on the way in. Play pass. Screen. James Owens out front. We evaded two tacklers, but finally coming up short, and it's going to be a fourth down situation. Number 86, Ron Suda. Defensive right tackle from the University of Missouri over there involved in the play. So the punter, Marty King, will come out. Football up in the air, hopefully high and deep. Number 34, Jimmy Rogers, running back out of Oklahoma, will be the lone man back there. Line drive, sinking type of punt. Pretty good coverage downfield. Number 54, Willie Bleicher from Oregon, involved in the tackle. Number 84, Jerry Robinson from UCLA, also another linebacker involved in the tackle.
And there's Jimmy Rogers, the running back from Oklahoma, who can play either halfback or fullback, averaged over 5 yards a carry. Forest City, Arkansas native.
Minucci still in the ball game, quarterback number 10 out of Kansas State University. Didn't like what had happened the last time, throwing an interception. We're going to have to go after again, 3 minutes to go. Into the flat, number 34, Jimmy Rogers. He was looking inside a quick slant to Charlie Green, number 24, for his teammate from K-State, but the linebacker dropped off, so that was really a wise decision to go out in the flat to number 34, Jimmy Rogers. Not risk an interception. That's a good play, picked up 7 yards, 8 yards. Now it's second down, two to go. Clock is stopped, 2 minutes, 57 seconds. They have plenty of time to get on the board. Intended for number 24, Charlie Green, but that ball got away from him way, way high. And maybe it was good that it was as high as it was because number 47, Mary Brazil, was back there. Couldn't quite jump up to get it.
Brazil was already looking at that other end zone. Had he been 3 inches taller, he'd have had it and been in that end zone. Number 47 there, you're looking at him, Larry Brazil, almost picked one off.
I tell you, the scouts like him down here. There's no way that they can hide him. I asked somebody what they thought of him, and I said, I heard that he was really an outstanding prospect. He said, I wish that he hadn't said that. I've been trying to hide him. Play pass. Lucci's in trouble, big trouble. Knocked down, 88, Jerry Wilkerson once again involved in the play, coming up with a big tackle on the number 10, Dan Minucci from Kansas State.
You know, I've got to be impressed with Wilkerson, 6'9", 263, Minucci's a fast guy. He's got 4 or 5 speed, but that time Wilkerson brought him down. Make that Wilkerson. I've been calling him Wilkerson, but his name is Jerry Wilkerson from Oregon State.
Got the receiving core back there. Number 22 is the man that they want to get the ball to. That's Kim Anderson, a man that can, as they say, can fly. I haven't seen a spiral yet on any of these kicks, but that ended up very well. Down to about the, it is a 24-yard line where it's going to be the Pac-10 ball. See who comes into the ball game at the quarterbacking position.
Len, you know, since I've been doing a disservice to Wilkerson by calling him Wilkinson, I'm going to plug his campus radio show known as Disco Jerry.
Two minutes, 35 seconds remaining, first half, 22-7, the Pac-10 leading the Big Eight.
Pac-10.
They want some more points. They get Thompson back in the ball game, and he hits his man out in the flat, number three, James Owens, UCLA speedster. And looking where it dropped down, just shy of the first down, almost the first down. And talking to them about their receiving core, they have just two. They have Reese, and they've got Sweeney. I said, what happens if they get hurt? He said, well, we got to go to James Owens. He's so versatile that he's able to play the wide receiving position.
Second.
This is a good time to throw. Big H looking for it anyway. Straight ahead. 37, Phil Francis picked up the first down. I said it was a good time to throw, with the exception I looked at the free safety and he was about 20 yards deep.
Phil Francis, the running back from Stanford, hampered quite a bit with injuries but came on strong this year to do a fine job.
We got 1:46 counting down remaining in first half, and take a look at number 14, Jack Thompson. See how he manipulates this two-minute drill. Looking deep, going deep. Sweeney's his man. He's got it. He is going to score. Doesn't take much. That's the best way to manipulate that two-minute clock.
Len, I like your comment. How is he going to use the two-minute drill? Well, he uses it the way he always does. He goes to number 24, Cal Sweeney. You're seeing 17, Mike Clemens here. Defensive back from Iowa State. Backpedaling, he gets burned. He underestimates the speed of Calvin Sweeney and the throwing ability of Jack Thompson. Thompson is right on the money. Hits his heel right there, but he can't stop Sweeney. He goes in for the TD.
Well, they were telling me down here, Don, that they felt that Thompson was the best quarterback, pro type of quarterback coming out of college this year, and he has not done anything to disprove that to me. So once again they get on the board. It's 29-7. Let's go down to the field for a special presentation and the winner of the Challenge Bowl 2 football trivia contest.
During the preceding 3 weeks, radio station KVI has been holding a football trivia contest, and tonight one of five finalists on this program will win a special Western Airlines all-expense-paid trip to the Caribbean. Among those finalists are Dean Beardsley, Holly Edwards, Dean Lovell, Mike Reed, and Betty Wilburn. Now, if Dee Mayhew, our charming Western Airlines Challenge Bowl hostess, will pull out the winning number, we'll really have some excitement.
All right. The lucky winner is Dean Lovell, the big KVI winner. Congratulations, Dean. That's fantastic. You are about to spend seven sunny days in the Caribbean on going down on Western Airlines. Congratulations.
All right. Thank you very much.
We are back, getting ready for the kickoff. 1 minute, 30 seconds remaining, second half. Deep men, 34. Jimmy Rogers, 24. Charles Green. Deep kick. Charles Green, a yard deep in the end zone. He's coming out with it. He's got a hole. He's got a lane. One man to beat. No, sir. Excellent return up to about the 42-yard line. 37, Phil Francis involved in the tackle. But number 24, Charlie Green, coming up with a big return, getting him a great field position.
Let's take a look at Charlie Green, taking it just 1 yard deep in the end zone there. He's got some pretty good blocking up front, but watch this move here. Veers to the outside, and right there is the move. He cuts back inside. Here it comes. Here it comes. Almost stopping in his tracks. Gets by number 37, Phil Francis there. No, that's Francis bringing him down, but he jukes someone from the Pac-10 real well.
Back to live action. Minucci, number 10, quarterback. Oh, is he hit? Ball is coughed up, but I think they're going to rule it dead. Number 92, Rich Dimler, USC, 6'6", 256 pounds. An outstanding nose tackle in college, and looks like an outstanding regular defensive tackle over the guard in pro ball. Sideline pattern. Charlie Green, he's got it.
Number 84, Jerry Robinson, linebacker, with his great quickness, was still able to get back in the play. That's a time there, though, that I believe Charlie should have caught the ball and jumped out of bounds. 48 seconds remaining, first half. 29-7, Pac-10 leading the Big 8. Ball is on the 47-yard line.
You know, fans, at halftime in a few minutes, you'll meet the 1978 Pepsi-Cola Little All-America team. You'll be seeing some of the college football's most exciting players. That'll be coming up right here on halftime.
Coming up right now, 48 seconds remaining on that clock. You're on the 47-yard line, Don. You know how easy it was for the throwing Samoan. It didn't take him long.
And there's a good look at the pack. The Big 8 bench there, they look a little subdued there on the sidelines. But no, had you had Jack Thompson on this side, you could get down there in a hurry. But let's see what Dan Minucci can do.
Well, Ray Hardy, number 28, is up the top of your screen. Minucci's looking, the ball is floating. He's got his man over the middle. Good throw and a good catch. Number 28, Ray Hardy.
Take a look at Dan Minucci, the quarterback from Kansas State. Got good protection this time, and he finds this man from Iowa State, Ray Hardy, down the middle. Minucci can pick up that yardage in a hurry also.
Only took 8 seconds on the clock because they stopped the clock when you get a first down in this ball game. That's like a college rule. It's counting down now. Looking for his back in the flat. He's got him. Number 21, Mike Kozlowski, was not able to get out of bounds. They better do something in a hurry. They should have utilized a timeout right there.
We're down to 22 seconds, and they're doing a little hurry-up number now. Dan Minucci and the Big 8 are.
Going to his same man, and he had him open, but he threw the ball behind him. If he had thrown the ball well there, he could have caught it and jumped right out of bounds.
I think the important thing was to stop the clock, though. We're down to 13 seconds, and the main thing he wanted to do was gain a little yardage, but more important than that, get that clock stopped. Now let's see what they can do.
Well, they need to get something on the board. I think to take something in at halftime, because the Pac-10 has been moving on that defensive unit of the Big 8. I think they have something to build on at halftime. Number 22 is Kimball, Bobby Kimball from Oklahoma. Intercepted. 25, John Paget from Stanford. Minucci was trying to manipulate, move out of the pocket. But he got a yellow flag down there. It's the third one so far. Face masking.
Face masking. And after Paget intercepted the ball, one of the Big 8 evidently grabbed his face mask.
Well, with 5 seconds remaining in the first half, he better grab something to make sure he didn't get away.
Okay, Len, you got 5 seconds left, and you got...
You ask me what they do, I tell you.
I tell you what, you got a quarterback named Thompson that can find Sweeney all day long, so why not do it once more?
I believe the defensive back. You're going to see Clemens back there about 20 yards. There's another man. Number 3, Owens. Clock is out. That's the end of the first half. Olympia Challenge Bowl number 2 from the Kingdome, Seattle, Washington, with the score, Pac-10 29, Big 8 7.
How does America spell relief?
In Detroit, for heartburn, we spell relief R-O-L-A-I-D-S.
Rolaid spells relief. In this test with Rolaid's active ingredient, laboratory acid changes color to prove Rolaid's consumes 47 times its weight in excess stomach acid. How does America spell relief?
In Albuquerque, for gas or acid indigestion, we spell it R-O-L-A-I-D-S.
All over America, Rolaid spells relief.
In 1906, Harvey Firestone built the first mechanically mounted pneumatic tires for his friend, Henry Ford. You know, Harvey sold a lot of tires because Henry sold a lot of cars. And then 1908, Harvey came up with the first non-skid tread pattern. You knew it was non-skid because it said so right on the tread. Harvey had a lot of good ideas. He was the first one to put rubber tires on a tractor, ever. You see, Harvey Firestone was never satisfied. He was always looking for a better way. And today, Firestone engineers are still looking for ways to make better tires. And that's led to the finest steel-belted radio Firestone has ever built, the 721. It's a product Harvey Firestone would have been proud of. Because, you know, he always said he wanted Firestone products to be the best today and still better tomorrow.
Let's pause for local station identification. This is the nation's leading independent television sports USA, the Mizlou Television Network.
The Coliseum Boat Show, 9 days of boating fun, all types of power and sailcraft, huge boaters gear locker, and much more. The Coliseum Boat Show starts Saturday.
TV Records is proud to introduce to American audiences the internationally renowned Roger Whittaker.
There's a ship now rigging ready in the harbor. Tomorrow for old England, she sails. Everybody talks about a new world.
All of Roger Whittaker's biggest hits have been compiled in this beautiful two-record collection, available for the first time anywhere.
Now all I see,
Roger Whittaker's All My Best. Two stereo LPs, $7.99. 8-track tape, $8.99. It's the entertainment value of the season.
For speedy delivery, call toll-free 1-800-241-8444. That's 1-800-241-8444. Call now. Operators are standing by. Save the COD charges and $7.99 for the records. $8.99 for 8-track tape to Roger Whittaker, 407 Southwest 11th Avenue, Portland, Oregon, 97205. That's 407 Southwest 11th Avenue, Portland.
Open line with Paul Lindman, Sunday nights on 8.
We're at halftime of the Olympia Challenge Bowl, and the Pac-10, the favorite among the fans here, out in front 29-7, ahead of the Big 8 All-Stars. It's been an exciting wide-open passing game, including one big 68-yard bomb from the throw-in Samoan Jack Thompson to Calvin Sweeney. That really sparked the crowd. I'm Steve Grad with Len Dawson and Don Perkins here with you. And, you know, because of a delay in obtaining some last-minute information, one player was left off of the National High School Athletic Coaches Association All-America football team. And that was at the halftime of the Blue-Gray game. Now we'd like to correct that. I'd like you to meet Bob Berry, a 6-foot, 185-pound quarterback from Southwest DeKalb High School in Decatur, Georgia. Bob, we're sorry we left you off. We'd like to wish you good luck and good luck to all the high school athletes. You know, high school football is the foundation for pro and college football, and not only in this sport, but in all the others, swimming, gymnastics, you name it. They work hard, and it'd be a good time to go out and support a high school football sport and team in your area. Now, coming up next on our halftime report, Don Tollison at Mizlou Control with the Pepsi Little All-America.
It's halftime at the Challenge Bowl. Hello again, I'm Don Tollison back at Mizlou Network Control. For our halftime feature today, we have a special treat. It is a look at the unsung All-American football players. Our Pepsi-Cola Little All-American team is brought to you by Pepsi-Cola, and your local Pepsi-Cola bottler, have a Pepsi day. In recent weeks, football fans all over the country have been bombarded by dozens of All-American teams. But most of the players on those teams come from traditional powers, the big schools. But today we have the unsung heroes. You may not have heard of them, but the pro scouts know who they are. Our defensive All-Americans begin with end Jim Haslett from Indiana University of Pennsylvania, 6'4", 230 from Avalon, PA, a two-time All-American. Defensive end John Mooring, CW Post, also a two-time All-American, 6'4", 235 from Locust Valley, New York. Defensive tackle Jesse Baker, Jacksonville State of Alabama, 6'5", 265 from Conyers, Georgia, had 7 fumble recoveries. Defensive tackle Robert Hardy, Jackson State, 6'5", 250 from Tulsa, 13 sacks this year. Middle guard Jim Curry, Nevada Reno, 6'3", 228 from Chowchilla, California, 12 sacks in 78. Linebacker Jerry Lumpkin, Northern Arizona, 6'2", 210 from Scottsdale, 404 career tackles. Linebacker Tim Tucker, Troy State, 5'10", 194 from Enterprise, Alabama, bench presses 400 pounds. Linebacker John Zamberlin, Pacific Lutheran, 6'2", 235 from Tacoma, bench presses 440. Defensive back Mike Betts. Austin Peay, 5'10", 185 from Fullerton, California, runs a 4.6 40. Defensive back Dennis Duncanson from Weber State, 5'11", 183 from Fullerton, California, another two-time All-American. Defensive back Bill Motes from the University of South Dakota, 6'1", 175 from Sioux Falls, South Dakota. He is also an outstanding punter. We will be back with our All-American offense right after this word from Pepsi.
It's so wonderful to make a child's dream come true. It's a moment of love, a joyous sensation.
For all of us here at Mizlou Television, want to thank Pepsi for their continued support of college division football all over America. All right, you have already met our little All-American defense. Right now, let's move to the offense. And once again, we start with a player from Weber State. Wide receiver Randy Jordan, 6'1", 200 pounds from Oakland, caught 62 passes for 1,078 yards this year. Wide receiver James Warren, Eastern Illinois, 6'4", 190 from Miami, had four touchdown passes in one game. Tight end Dan Ross, Northeastern University, 6'4", 238 from Everett, Mass, 153 passes caught in his career. Tight end John Borshaw, Montana State, 6'4", 225 from Minneapolis, studies microbiology. Tackle Billy John, Texas A&I, 6'4", 245 from Carrizo Springs, Texas. He was his team's captain. Center Frank Baressa from Lawrence University, 6'2", 200 from Kekana, Wisconsin. His team was 30-6 during his career. Guard Bruce Kimball, University of Massachusetts, 6'2", 255 from Raleigh, Mass. Also an excellent hockey player. Guard Tyrone McGriff, Florida A&M, 6'260 from Gifford, Florida, another two-time All-American. Quarterback Jeff Comlow from the University of Delaware, 6'3", 210 from College Park, Maryland. We have some film to show you the kind of form that made Jeff so successful. He, in fact, was the first quarterback to start as a sophomore at Delaware since 1951. He did that two seasons ago. He passed for 5,417 yards in his career. You can see that fine touch right there. Tubby Reaman, the coach at Delaware, does a fine job every year. All right, our running backs, Frank Hawkins from Nevada, Reno, 5'11", 190 from Las Vegas, gained 1,449 yards this year. And finally, Jerry Aldridge from Angelo State, 6'2", 210 from Jacksonville, Texas. We also have some film of Jerry. We're going to show you the kind of form that gave him a string of 17 straight 100-yard games. Get these statistics. This year, 1,483 yards on the ground for 14 touchdowns. You can see that explosiveness that the pro scouts really like in Jerry Aldridge. I kind of have a feeling we're going to be seeing Jerry Aldridge and a whole lot of these little All-Americans coming up in the next few years in the National Football League. For one thing, it's great that these schools are finally getting the recognition they deserve. And speaking of which, this year the Maxwell Club in Philadelphia gave their National Football League Player of the Year award to Terry Bradshaw. You'll remember Terry played his college ball at Louisiana Tech. That's another one of those schools finally getting the credit it deserves. And all of us here at Mizlou are proud to announce that next year, when the Maxwell Club announces its College and Pro Players of the Year, we're going to be involved in all the festivities there. We're also going to be involved in coverage of their great research to improve the safety of the game of football down at the Maxwell Club in Philadelphia. All right, today's Pepsi Cola Little All-American team was brought to you by Pepsi Cola and your local Pepsi Cola bottler. We'll be right back with the second half of the Challenge Bowl from Seattle right after this word from your local station.
To Levitt's lately. you haven't been to Levitt's.
All Levitt's Pacific Northwest locations are celebrating the grand opening of our new Concord, California showroom with fabulous values like these open stock bedroom pieces. $88 for twin size poster bed. Chest, open hutch, corner desk, student desk. On sale for $88 each. Matching pieces sale price too during Levitt's grand opening celebration.
You love it at Levitt's.
But right now at halftime, you're watching a television first. This is a men's against the women's football game. The team with the ball is the Redmond Sex Killers. They're wearing Seattle Seahawks style uniforms. They are the women's team, and they are trailing 7-0 in this game. These are women in the blue moving the ball left to right. Look at that tackle. The guys are on the right, and I'm waiting for flags for illegal use of the hands by some of the guys, but these gals are good athletes. They're dedicated. They're competitors. And I'll tell you, the men have a no-win proposition when they go against these women, because Bob Scraber, an art director who made a touchdown, was booed as he was running. The gals have the ball. Nice move. Look at that pitch. I'll bet Dawson never did anything like that. Oh, boy. They tried to take the ball away from Jeanette Greeny. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you're going to see a work of art. This is the first replay slow-mo in the history of women's televised football. What a pitch. That's the old alley-oop to the left pitch. And good catch. You can pick up some pointers here. These are the men against the women, and the men are only winning 7-0. Now, these gals have been playing for 7 years, and they have never lost a football game. Never. And the mascot from the Seahawks decides to give the referee a break, and this gal here has a problem on running with the ball because the men can grab her hair. That might have been called a hippie ball player a few years ago, but that's one of the sex killers for the Redmond School District, by the way. They help support high school athletics in the Redmond area here. Now the men have the ball. You're going to watch these gals do some tackling, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, we've got a little bit of flea flicker action here. Good defensive work. These people are not afraid. They scrimmaged against some men, although we have a flag. And no wisecracks now. That was not one of the handkerchiefs as an accoutrement to the women's uniforms. Those are uniforms identical to the Seattle Seahawks, except they are the Redmond Sex Killers. And I can't emphasize enough, if you're just joining us here at halftime of the Challenge Bowl, that the team on the left is a women's team. They have men coaches. But they're going against the men's ball club, and the penalty was against the men. So they mark it off down inside the 15 to some scoring position for the women here. And with me up in the booth, by the way, folks, is Earl McCarron of the Dean Winter Reynolds Company, who's really helping support these collegiate football games. What did you think of the first half?
Well, it's a great game, Steve. Really enjoyed it.
You think the Big Eight can come back?
Well, Thompson and Sweeney are tough to beat.
Well, it's been a lot of excitement and wide open, and now we see on the men's play, hey, that's good gang tackling. They know where that ball is, the gals do, and they put that big guy down. This is an interesting game.
It sure is. I like to be out there.
You think in the future we might have some men-women's bowl game?
Well, it would be interesting.
By the way, we want to stress our thanks to the way Dean Witter Reynolds does support collegiate football. This is an outstanding thing, and it's growing, and we sure appreciate it.
Thank you, Steve. Appreciate being here.
Okay. Earl McCarron of Dean Witter Reynolds Company. As we go back to action of the Redmond Sex Killers. And by the way, we're going to be back a little bit later to announce the Dean Witter Reynolds most valuable player of the Olympia Challenge Bowl, and that'll be later in the ball game. Well, on this note of gang tackling by the women, we'll have more halftime activity after these messages from your local stations. It's halftime at the Olympia Challenge Bowl. Pac-10 leads the Big 8 29-7, but this is men against the women, and the women have the ball. The Redmond Sex Killers are on the move. They're trailing 7-0, but right now the men have outplayed them. Hey, the women aren't afraid to use kind of crazy options here, but the men weren't fooled on that one. Women aren't bad on defense, I must tell you, and I'm sure a lot of people who've gone out on dates know that. They're clad in the same color uniforms of the Seahawks. Some of these gals have occupations other than playing football. They are teachers, secretaries, and freelance writers. As we get the final gun for this intersex game, the Metro Muggers defeating the women 7-0. And we'll be back with the start of the second half in just a moment.
The second half of today's Challenge Bowl 2 is brought to you by Olympia Beer. Olympia's been a favorite with sports fans for as long as I can remember. Like they say, Olympia makes every game great. By Toyota. Toyota hopes you're enjoying today's 1979 Challenge Bowl. Your local Toyota dealer has got the 1979 car or truck you've been looking for. You asked for it, you got it. Toyota. And by Dean Witter Reynolds, one investment firm you'll be glad to hear from. Promotional consideration provided by Chloraseptic, the medicine for fast, temporary relief of minor sore throat pain. Chloraseptic makes a sore throat feel better, so you feel better. Turtle Wax, the world's largest selling liquid car wax, new improved hard shell formula. Cleans, polishes, protects in one easy operation. Turtle Wax with the hard shell finish. Staticide eliminates dust catching static from carpets, furniture, everything in your home, even laundry. Reduce costly cleaning and housework with amazing Staticide.
We're at halftime of the Olympia Challenge Bowl, and with me is Tom Honan of Olympia Brewing Company. And well, what'd you think of this first half, Tom?
It was a pretty good first half, a lot of scoring.
Are you a little biased to the Pac-10?
Well, being a West Coast person, I guess I am.
Listen, I think that though the Big Eight's going to put up a big fight though in the second half.
Well, they moved the ball a little bit in the first half. Maybe they'll get a little better in the second half here.
What's the future of the Challenge Bowl? Is it going to be another conference in the future?
We hope to be able to bring the game back again next year.
And I'm sure the people from the Southeast Conference, Southwest Conference, several of the other big ones around the nation are just waiting their turn to get hold of these Pac-10 players.
I guess so.
Okay, I know the fans like it, and we want to thank Olympia Brewing for their great support of collegiate football. And you see some young ball players out there getting ready for the second half. And I want to thank Tom Homan of Olympia Brewing Company for being with us here at halftime, with the Pac-10 leading the Big Eight by the score of 29-7. We're going to be bringing in Len Dawson and Don Perkins to call the second half for you momentarily in a game that's wide open with a lot of passing. You got the throw in Samoan out there from Washington State for the Pac-10, and you know there's going to be some wide open ball playing, and these fellas in the white, the Big Eight, really have to do something to stop it and get uncorked on their own, Lenny.
Well, they're not getting any pressure on Thompson in the first place. And you know, if you give him any time at all, if you give him a lane to see through, people to throw to, and he's got people to throw to. Calvin Sweeney and Severn Reese have done an outstanding job in the first half. Reese, 7 receptions, 5 for Sweeney, and so far Thompson's had a pretty good first half, 264 yards in passing. So,
well, Len, I think you hit the nail right on the head when you said nobody's put pressure on Thompson. And the Big Eight, if they're going to do anything in this ball game, have got to get some pressure on Thompson. He can throw the football. Sweeney can get open. He's got a lot of excellent receivers, got good runners. That defensive line for the Big Eight has got to come on.
Well, we've got number 34, Jimmy Rogers, back to receive, along with 28 Ray Hardy from Iowa State. The Big Eight's got to get something going, Don. They can't lay back. Man going to be putting it up in the air, Paul Watson from Washington State. Circling the ball, and we're underway. A short, high kick. Taken by the up man. That looked like number 21, Mike Kozlowski. Number 25, John Pickett, coming up with the stop, knocking him out of bounds. So the Big Eight gets a hold of the football here at the beginning of the second half. They are trailing by the score of 29-7. Looking in the ball game, number 12, Tom Sorley of Nebraska will be the starting quarterback the second half. Number 6, Thomas Lott, quarterback. Turn running back in the ball game. Little movement up on that line. Looked like the offensive left side moved before the snap of the ball. It's going to cost him 5 yards. Just a recap of the offensive unit for the Big Eight. Number 12, Sorley, quarterback. It'll be 34, Rogers. 21, Kozlowski. Lott, number 6, as the running backs. Number 24, Charlie Green. Number 28, Ray Hardy. 22, Bobby Kimball will be the wide receivers. The men that I just mentioned, they're the men that the quarterback wants to get the football to. Back to pass. Over the middle. He's got his tight end. 88, Guy Preston.
Nice completion that time to Guy Preston, the big tight end. He was brought down at 45. Bruce Beakley, Larry Brazil also was in on it. Sorley was the victim of dropped passes in the first half of the game. He really threw the ball pretty well, but he had several of them dropped.
He's got a situation now, an excellent situation, coming up with the second and two situation that they can run with the football or he can put it up in the air. Straight ahead, off the right side. Not much there, though. Number 21, Mike Kozlowski.
Going to be very close. He did, as a matter of fact, pick up the necessary yardage for a first down on that one, Len. So he squeezed it out.
They gave it to him, and we might remind the people, too, of the eight-point rule. If you're down by more than 8 points and you score, you have the option of receiving the ensuing kickoff. Split backfield. Up the middle to Thomas Lott. No, sir. Nowhere to go. Number 92, Rich Dimmler, was not faked by that play fake type of situation. The guard pulling, and he was there to make the stop.
Boy, that's what you call filling the hole. Thomas Lott, the ball carrier, hit it on that one, and Rich Dimmler looked like he must have been about 4 feet wide. Let's take a look at it again from the ground level. Quarterback Sorley there doing a little move there, handing off, and right there, look at that, a good fundamental position by Dimmler.
He wanted to make him think it was a pitch out, but he was not fooled. Draw play. Up the middle, number 6, Thomas Lott, trying to find some running room, nothing there, and once again, number 92, Rich Dimmler is there, along with 95, Manu Tiasosopo. I might better watch myself, I'm beginning to pronounce his name correctly, I think. Offensive line, let's take a look at the big eight. 73 is Clark, 56 Cotton, 60 Monroe, 61 Griffin, 63 Clappin. They're the men responsible for opening up some seams in that line. Look out! A big paw was thrown up in the air. Manu Tuiasosopo.
Yeah, Tuiasosopo did a great job on that one. He could not get to the quarterback Sorley, and he's learned very early. If you can't get it to him, get your hands up in the flight of the ball, and he deflected it.
Billy Todd back in punt formation on fourth down, and they have some 8 yards to go. Taking a look at deep men. Number 22, Kim Anderson, back to receive the kick. There won't be any rush on the punter of such. Nobody coming at all. High kick, fair catch by Anderson. He's under it, makes the catch on about the 22, 23 yard line, where the Pac-10 will take over. More football action from the Kingdome in Seattle, Washington, after this important timeout.
At a time like this, you probably don't care that we carbonate our beer naturally, or use only choice barley malt or pure artesian brewing water. But you'd taste the difference if we didn't, so we do. Olympia. It's the water, and a lot more.
It's really hard to believe that this colorless cream will let me gradually get rid of just as much gray as I want.
Grecian Formula 16, famous clear liquid and now new cream. It's colorless, easy to use as hair cream, no mess. Use a little every day. You're in complete control of just how much gray you slowly get rid of. Some of it, most of it, or all of it.
Now I use it just once a week or so. It's a cinch to keep it this way, looking perfectly natural.
Grecian Formula 16, famous liquid and now cream.
We are back. Now the Pac-10 with the ball, also with a big lead, 29-7. 12 minutes, 32 seconds remaining in this quarter. Number 14, Jack Thompson, back at quarterback. Number 3, James Owens, going to the outside, picking up a little blocking, a little room, and about a 7 yard gain. The Otis Brown coming up, number 27, the fullback, coming up with a good block, giving him a little opportunity, a little breathing room. That's all he needs, is just a little bit.
Work is cut out for the Big Eight. Trailing 29-7 here in the third quarter, they're going to have to stop the Pac-10 and score some points to get back in this ball game. Otherwise, we can call it an evening. Phil Francis in the ball game, and he gets the call straight ahead. Not much room at all up the middle of that defensive line of the Big Eight. As everybody sizes everything up, they'll say, wait a minute, let's bring on out the chains and take a look. We can't even make a guess, Don, with all those big heavyweights hanging around where the ball is. I say they made it. Of course, I waited until he moved with his hand forward. Ten yards. That's what it is. 10 yards, 1 inch.
First and 10.
Theodis Brown in the backfield along with number 3, James Owens. Quick screen out to Reese. Oh, yes. Good tackle. Good open field tackle by number 31, William Fisher, who's moved from the safety position over to that cornerback position.
Sort of a naked screen on this one. Reese, the receiver out here on this Thompson pass, but nobody's blocking at all. He does a little hitch there, comes back, but he's got not a blocker in front of him, and he can't shake the defensive man, Fisher. Does a good job. Keeps right with him. Bill Fisher from Kansas State.
I formation once again. Play pass again. Looking down to who else but number 24, Calvin Sweeney, coming up with another big catch and another first down. They're giving him so much room, Don, when he goes down because of his speed. And when he cuts to the inside or the outside, there's a lane there, and there's a lot of room between that cornerback and the linebacker.
I tell you what, he's found himself a home in that Big Eight secondary. He's been back there all evening, and Thompson's been able to find him.
First and 10 at the 49-yard line. Act 10 moving once again. Split formation or split backfield. Pitch out. Theodis Brown, the big fullback, and he'll pick up about 3 or 4 yards. And that's a sign that they have a lot of faith in the ability of a man that's 236 pounds that can get outside. It's because you've got to outrun some people. Got to outrun that defensive end. Taking a look at the defensive unit, 77, Ken Bugatta, MU, Frank King, 76, KU, Ron Suda, 86, MU, 74, Phil Tabor from Oklahoma. That's the front four. He's going to have to put some pressure on this Jack Thompson, this man right here. Punch. 37, Phil Francis, quick hitting play up the middle. A couple of yards, going to bring up a third down and about 3 situation.
It was interesting the way the practice sessions went out here earlier this week, Lynn. The Big Eight ball club worked very hard. Coach Wilkinson had to tell him to ease up. He was afraid he was going to get part of his 33-man squad hurt. On the other hand, the Pac-10 and Coach John McKay just had more fun. It was a very casual kind of thing, but they're here to play this evening.
Theodis Brown fighting, and I think he may have picked up the first down.
I think he probably did, too. He did, the official signaling that he did pick it up. Not because there was a hole there, just because Theodis Brown made his own way. Just kept driving and forced his way for that necessary yardage.
The man has that ability and that power to go inside, and the play before, the ability to jump outside on a pitch out, that means he has to outrun the defensive tackle and the defensive end because they don't block those people. He has to outrun them. I formation, play pass. No, I'm talking about the pressure. They finally did it. They finally put some pressure on him. It looks 76, Franklin King.
University of Kansas was the man to get to number 14, Jack Thompson. I say pressure because he's had a couple of operations. He had both shoulders operated on, and also he's got a knee problem.
That was the most pressure that Thompson's had put on him all evening. Here he rolls out, gets a little bit right there is the pressure from Franklin King. King doesn't really tackle him, but he belts him a good lick, and it was enough to send Thompson to the turf.
Well, he was looking at 76 King, and also 69 Chester Jeffrey was on his way. Made the wise decision and went down. Nobody open. Good coverage in the secondary because he pumped twice before he finally put it down. Number 69, Chester Jeffery from K-State. 6'5", 255 pounds was the man that wrapped his arms around the quarterback and put him down very gently. Give that quarterback time. He'll kill you. The only thing you can do, you've got to put some pressure on him. You don't have to necessarily get to him, but if you put pressure on to make him throw before he wants to, that's accomplishing the job as a defensive lineman. Reverse. Big fullback, Theodis Brown. Avoids one tackle, and he comes up and makes the tackle again.
Jeff Lee was the guy that hit Theodis Brown as he was trying to come wide. Theodis then reversed his field. Let's take a look at it again in slow motion. There's Theodis Brown. You're going to see number 57, Jeff Lee, get a shot at him. Right there. Bounces off. Theodis says, I can't go that way. I'll go back. But waiting for him is Jeff Lee. Makes the tackle. Good play that time by Lee.
That's right. Theodis is a big man, but he better utilize those big linemen. Stay behind them, not in front of them. All right. We got our lead man, Charlie Green. K-State back to get the kick. He's angling for out of bounds. And it's caught by number 3, Gary Irons. Let's pause 60 seconds for these messages from your local station.
These are the stories that you'll see on We're On This Week. We're going to go inside the Blazer locker room with reporter Melissa Hellerbeck. We're going to review the new movie Superman. We're also going to go for a ride on a neat bus that bends in the middle. And Herm Gilliam is going to show us some fancy basketball drills. Plus, we'll learn how to do the line dance, 48th and Main. So don't miss We're On this Sunday night at 5:30 on Channel 8.
Don't forget, Our Evening and Yours now starts at 7:30. Join us, Paul Lindman
and Cheryl Hansen, weeknights at 7:30 here on Channel 8.
Home, 6 minutes, 11 seconds remaining, third period. And the score is 29-7, Pac-10 leading the Big 8. Big 8 with the ball, number 12. Tom Sorley will be at the helm. Thomas Lott, number 6. Trying to get him some running room. Number 5, Manu Tiasosopo. And number 53, Gary Cobb, a linebacker involved in the stop. He picked up about 6 yards. It's not a bad call. Anytime you pick up 5 or 6 yards, it's a good play.
But when you're down 29-7 with 5 minutes left in the third quarter,
you want to pick up 6 points, not 6 yards. They're in a split backfield. Back to throw. That's the second time, number 95, Manu Tuyosisopo batted down a pass.
Let's look at him, Manu Tuyosisopo.
You say that real nice, too.
Okay, watch him. Let's see. Bouncing off. There he goes. Goes airborne and gets his hand in the flight of the ball. Quarterback Tom Sorley was back there beating his helmet. He knew he should have gone around him. You can't throw through a guy that big.
For pass blocking, that was a good job of pass blocking because he held his man out. Quick out. Pellegrin's got it. Number 22, Kim Anderson, defensive man on the scene. Good enough for first down. Clock will stop, 5:23 remaining third period. 29-7, Pac-10 leading the Big 8.
You know, fans, the LPGA comes to Mizlou on Sunday, May 20th, for the finals of the $100,000 Coca-Cola Classic at the Upper Montclair, New Jersey Country Club. Nancy Lopez is the defending champion, and you can see it on many of these Mizlou stations.
Nancy Lopez, what a tremendous year she had. Straight ahead, number 21, Mike Kozlowski, picking up good running room. Number 84, Jerry Robinson, linebacker. Number 31, Johnny Lynn, safety involved in the tackle.
Big 8's moving the ball pretty consistently now on the ground, but they need to start scoring points, Lynn. You know, these long, sustained drives, we don't have time for it. We're looking at a man limping off the field here. Number 56, it's Barney Cotton. Looks like maybe it's a knee problem that, or an ankle problem that he's having. We hope it's not serious.
I think the way that he's moving right now, hopefully it isn't too serious. It's serious to Barney, I can assure you that, folks. Number 75, Greg Simmons from Oklahoma State, 6'4", 270-pound lineman, will take the place of Cotton. Second, very short yardage to go. Good down to do anything you want with it. And he's got a play pass call. Firing the ball. Tip, 22, Anderson comes up with the football. He can run, he's the man that returns punts. Second interception of the afternoon, or the evening, I should say. Number 63, Sam Clappin, was the offensive lineman that brought him down, but that ball was tipped.
Sorley, with not much yardage there to pick up, tried to go for the big one on this one. He's dropping back there. You're looking at number 45, Bruce Beakley. He's the man, I think, that's going to get his hand on the ball to deflect it. Goes high in the air. We can't see it, but he was the one to deflect it into the hands of Kim Anderson, number 22. Anderson doing a good job running it back upfield before he's finally smacked to the turf.
Looky here, by the time that you got talking about that interception, we came up with an interception by number 31, William Fisher. Thompson wanted to get 6 points in a hurry. He was going for Severn Reese deep in the corner, but the ball was slightly underthrown. It was a good defensive play by William Fisher coming up with the interception, so they'll go back to the 20-yard line, and the Big 8 will get the ball right back.
Well, we had a lot of movement there, all for naught. We're right back where we started. Big 8's got the ball. Pac-10 still has the lead, 29-7, with 4:23 left in the third quarter.
A good move by Big 8 coach is moving Fisher from the safety to the corner. He's done a good job since he's been out there. Once again, Sorley's going to go back, throwing it out to 21, Mike Kozlowski. Comes up with a few yards. Number 95, Manu Tuyas Nasopo, showing his versatility by getting out there, getting involved in the tackle. What Sorley can't afford to do now, he looks like he's guiding some of his throws, Don. He's got to go back there with the authority and throw the thing.
You know? Yeah, getting a little bit intimidated. He's had some problems getting them deflected and that kind of thing, but he's got to loosen up and throw with confidence.
See, the ball is taken off on him. Ball is taken off and intended for Bobby Kimball, number 22 of Oklahoma. He's not firing that ball. 47, Larry Brazil was a defensive cornerback who was out in the position, but the man was open had he pumped it at the letters, chest high. Hi. She's enjoying the evening here at the Kingdome. Right now, the Pac-10 is enjoying the evening at the Kingdome. Third and six for the Big 8. Yes, sir, he's got his man. 28, Ray Hardee, on a turning pattern. He stepped up and threw that football that time, Don. Number 45, Bruce Beakley. He's been all over the field. Number 22, Kim Anderson, involved in the tackle. They need to get something going now. 3:30 remaining third period. They haven't scored since the first quarter. They shut out in the second quarter. Good play defensively. Number 25, John Piggott, the safety, came up, saw that pitch out coming, did a great job of stopping the man about three or four yards deep in the secondary of the offense.
Well, that's what you call forcing a play. Piggott saw that one coming all the way and took out the interference and the ball carrier. Good job that time by John Piggott, the defensive back from Stanford.
A lot coming out. Jimmy Rogers, number 34. Oklahoma coming in the ball game, so a couple of Oklahoma Sooners exchanging positions, one to the sideline, one in the backfield. Screen pass to the tight end, number 88, Preston. But there's another 88 there, Jerry Wilkerson, the defensive end. He read that screen, got back in, and did a great job.
Guy Preston's a nice target for a pass for a quarterback, but he's not your best runner going 6'7", 225. Let's take a look at number 25, John Piggott. Just made an outstanding play earlier. This time he does it again. Shoots right by a would-be blocker and trips up the pass receiver, Preston, just going by.
Yeah, he ran right by number 61, Dave Griffin. Sorely to pass. Looking for help. Good throw, good catch. Right on the money. Number 28, Ray Hardee, Iowa State. 6 feet, 188 pounder.
Good pass route that time by Hardee, and Sorley looking like he's got his confidence back throwing. He really rifles this one in there. It's a little bit low. Hardee had to go down, but a fine pass, a fine catch. Big Eight really needs more yardage than this. It's a nice sustained drive, but they don't have time for it.
Uh-oh, where did he go, he said. Now I'm going to utilize my running ability. Call timeout.
He says, why me? Why me, Lord? Why me?
I'll mix up back there. One man went one way, the other went the other way, and the quarterback ended up with a football.
Tom Sorley, the number one passer for the Cornhuskers in the history of Cornhusker football.
They've had some very outstanding quarterbacks at Nebraska. David Hum comes to my mind right away now with Oakland. He's going to have to do it now. Going deep, going up top. 22, Kimball. He's got a step. He's got the ball. 7 yard line.
Take a look at it again. I don't know if you can catch it at the extreme left of your screen. You're going to see some movement. Right there is number one of them. Number 73 doing the movement is Kelvin Clark. I also think he had number 88, Guy Preston, working with him.
He was following Preston. Really?
Somebody was following somebody anyway.
Time to go, I guess. No, sir. Since the whistle was not blown, the play went, they lost the yard, so they refused to penalty. Now on the 8 yard line, second, goal to go. Lot can pass. Threw it away. Nobody opened, threw the ball away. Thomas Lott was in the ball game, and I say he's a quarterback and he can pass, and I'm sure that the Pac-10 is well aware of that. But would have been an opportunity on first down to give him the ball maybe on a pitch out or a sweep and let him throw it, much like what happened with James Owen throwing the ball to
right.
Calvin Sweeney in the first quarter for a touchdown.
Not much room to maneuver back there, so the Pac-10 defenders didn't have too much of a problem. They did a good job of covering the receivers coming out for the big eight.
This is a good opportunity down here for crossing patterns because it's going to be man-to-man coverage. You have the tight end run from one side to the other. Or just give it to that man. Number 24, Charlie Green, Kansas State, coming up with a score, a much-needed score, I must say, for the Big Eight.
Well, you talked about a crossing pattern, Len, and this is exactly what you had. Charlie Green there coming from your left to your right, going the entire width of the field, just outrunning the defenders. Number 47, Larry Brazil, trying to cover him, but could not get to him. Here's a look at it again. Sorley doing a good job, getting good protection this time. Hasn't had much protection.
Good pass route.
Number 45, Bruce Beakley, was around there once again. He's a middle linebacker. But that's tough on a defensive back. Number 47, Larry Brazil, had to chase him all the way from one side to the other. So he's always going to be chasing him if the quarterback has time and he gets the ball there. Play pass. Wide open in the flat. Number 21, Mike Kozlowski. More football action after this timeout. Well, as we told you earlier in the telecast, that if you're down by 8 points or more, you have the option after you score to receive the ball. Taking a look at the deep men, we've got number 34 back there is Johnny Rogers. 28, Ray Hardy. A little seam, little room, back to about the 27, 28-yard line, where he is met by number 54, Willie Blasher from Oregon. 32 seconds remaining in this third period. And taking a look at the score right now, we've got 29 to 15, the Pac-10 leading the Big 8. Don, I guess that rule of 8 points makes it, can always keep this game interesting. Yep. But you have to score first. Quick out. Harty breaks a tackle.
Hey, good move.
Down to about the 48-yard line. 23 seconds remaining.
Great move that time by Harty. Kim Anderson and John Pickett both had a shot at him, but he kept his balance and whirled away from both of them, picked up good yardage, and stopped the clock.
And they're in excellent field position right now to go on and move. 29-15, Pac-10, leading the Big 8, so they're a couple of scores away. We've got a whole quarter to go. We're going to have a lot of action right here at the Kingdome in Seattle, Washington. Straight ahead, number 21, Mike Kozlowski, been the workhorse so far this evening for the Big 8. Brought down by number 53, Gary Cobb from USC, a linebacker, and also 95, Manu Tuiasosopo. All right, it's the Pac-10 29, Big 8 15, end of the third quarter.
Let's pause for local station identification. This is the nation's leading independent television sports USA, the Mizlou Television Network.
Flashing over the left side, he's picking up a first down.
You know, he's a good-looking running back. He's been plagued with injuries there at Colorado, but he's 6'2", 192, and coming on real well. He's healthy right now. I'm sure the pro scouts are quite interested in him.
I'll say that, and because he can do a lot of things. He's a good blocker, and he's an excellent pass receiver also. More things that you can do, better chance you have of making it in the pros. First down. Thomas Lott, number six, looking for some room. Not much. Number 84, Jerry Robinson, linebacker from UCLA, three-time All-American. He's the first man to do that since the Doak did it back at SMU. Doak
in the 50s or something like
no,
that?
No, Doak Walker's in the 40s.
When the 40s?
You remember those days?
My
you were
God.
Playing back
well,
there.
Well, no, I was just a kid, Len. I'm sorry.
I read it in a book. Second five for the Big 8. Sorley, number 12, a quarterback, shifting his big tight end, Hicks, to the other side. Going back to throws. Looking. Looking for RD, and it's a good thing he threw it away by everybody. Nobody was really open. Good coverage back there by number 47, Larry Brazil from USC.
And number 31, safety man Johnny Lynn from UCLA.
Sorley, with good pass protection that time, he had plenty of time to find someone open, but nobody got open. Excellent job of defensive play by the Pac-10 secondary.
That's when you have to know your receivers and where everybody is. He's pumping around there. He should have had an outlet man, somebody to go to.
Someone, yeah.
Delay pattern to the big tight end, number 80, Victor Hicks from Oklahoma. And I say big, he's a big 6'3", 251-pound tight end. He's not used to the football in the air at Oklahoma. I don't think they threw it to him very often. Number 96, Kyle Heinrich.
Father was a great football player at the University of Washington, I believe, and also with the New York Giants. Spent some time also with the Dallas Cowboys in their early expansion years. Head coach Bud Wilkinson, now with the St. Louis Cardinals, after that fantastic career at the University of Oklahoma.
Fourth and one. Here it is. They've been stopped twice before in situations just like this, Don. They need to pick up a first down very badly. Play pass. Good play. Good fake. Victor Hicks, number 80. That's two in a row for him. That should be a record for the big tight end of catching the ball. That's not the man that he wanted to go to because he was looking for the back coming out of the backfield, but on a delayed pattern, number 80, Victor Hicks.
6'3", 250 pounds. He's not your deep threat. He's primarily a blocker for the Oklahoma Sooners, but he has pretty good hands. Caught two in a row, and there, speaking of blockers, big Abe Gibran there.
A Boilermaker. Ex-Boilermaker. Oh, good hard hit. Good shot. Number 54, Willie Blasher from Oregon. Put the shoulder pads right where they're supposed to.
Tell you what, all the youngsters watching football and wanting to know how to tackle a guy, that was a classic example of a fundamental football position and driving the man back.
Pac-10, Big 8, action continues right after this timeout. We are back. It's second down, about 9 yards to go. The Big 8 looking for more points. They need more points right now. Sorley back to throw. Quick out. He's got his man. Ray Hardy, number 28 from Iowa State, has done an outstanding job so far this evening. Number 22, Kim Anderson, let him know that he was around, Don, and put a little leather to him when he made the catch.
Kim Anderson's been a busy man. He's been burned a few times, came up with several big plays, and that time he really laid the wood on number 28, Ray Hardy. Passing combination looking better now for the Big 8. Sorley is throwing with a lot of accuracy. As we look at the defensive team for the Pac-10 there, digging in, they've got their backs to the wall.
Two tight ends in the ball game right now and one wide receiver. That wide receiver is Bobby Kimball. Play action pass going, wide open. In the flat, number 6, Thomas Lott from Oklahoma. Now he knows what it feels like to be on the other side of the receiving line.
Well, Tom Lott also gets a feeling of what it's like to throw a pass a little low where the receiver has to dive for it. The quarterback, Sorley, there has got him wide open. Throws it a little bit behind him, a little low, but he got it to him. And a good passing combination. Here, let's look at it again from the ground level. Lott coming out, he's wide open.
You know,
nobody within 5 yards.
There's supposed to be somebody out there.
Yeah.
There's supposed to be a linebacker, and number 54, Willie Blasher, was the man that was taken by that fake, that he was faked out, because that's man-to-man coverage down there, and his man is the halfback. Going for the 2 points. Play pass again, he's going to try it again. This time to the big tight end, number 88, Guy Preston. It's good for the 2 points. So let's pause 60 seconds. For these messages from your local station. We are back, but this time the Big 8 is not going to receive the ball once again because they have narrowed the gap. Pac-10 now leading 29-23, and we said it had to be an 8-point difference. So it's going to be Billy Todd kicking off to the Pac-10, and the number 3 is looming back there, and that would be James Owen. Number 21, Lynn Kane also, but it's a short kick. You can get up and run with it. That's a pro ball. Number 50, George Yarno, offensive lineman. trying to figure out what he was going to do with the ball now that he had it.
You know, there's some indecision down there. He got up and ran with it, and the official blew the whistle and then let it stay where his forward progress was, so the officials had to think on it, too.
It's getting close. Number 14, Jack Thompson, back at quarterbacking, I formation. Number 3, James Owens, going up the middle of the line from that I formation. Not much gain on that play. Maybe give him a couple of yards. About the second down situation. And about 9, 8.5 yards to go. Now is not the time to get conservative.
Game really turned around. It looked like the Big 8 was out of it starting into the second half, and they've really made a move.
Play pass. Oh, ball took off. Intended for number 24, Calvin Sweeney. Yeah, he heard about what it's like to have to leap up in the air with two defensive men around him.
And Mike Clemens did an excellent job that time on Sweeney. Clemens was all over him on that one. Sweeney's been getting open all evening, but that time Clemens laid the wood on him.
We're coming up now. It's a third down situation. They still have 8 yards remaining for a first down. Mr. Thompson's going to have to go to work. Good move. Excellent move. In trouble. And number 24, Calvin Sweeney, saw that, and he came back toward the quarterback, giving him some place to throw. But there is one of those yellow flags laying down that green turf.
You know, while we're awaiting that decision, I'm still impressed with quarterback Thompson. He got pressure put on him that time. He did the wise thing, showed a lot of quickness rolling out of the pocket, keeping his concentration, finding his receiver, Sweeney, who did an excellent job, too, breaking off his pass route and coming back to help a quarterback in trouble. It's all for naught, though, because there's a walk-off against the Pac-10. Holding.
Makes it going to be third down once again, and a little bit more yardage to pick up. But number 14, Thompson, has indicated in the first half in particular that is no big problem whatsoever. He gets the protection. He's got two outstanding receivers, wide receivers, to throw to. Going up top, trying to do it again, 24. No, sir, but is it close? Oh, that was a great catch, even though it was out of bounds, by number 24, Calvin Sweeney, showing what concentration is all about.
I tell you what, that's a great pass by Thompson, and just excellent concentration by Sweeney. There's your quarterback, Thompson, throwing it airborne. And watch this concentration, number 24, Sweeney, fighting against Mike Clemens, keeping his eye on the ball all the way. The pass did take him out of bounds, so it's all for naught, but a great catch by Sweeney.
Yeah, it's a great concentration. If he hadn't bobbled the ball, it would have been caught inbounds. Number 4, Marty King, back in punt formation. And we take a look. It's Charlie Green back in single safety, trying to retrieve it. Another end-over-end kick. He's going to field this one, bring it back to the left side. Nothing there. Nothing there. From the Kingdome in Seattle, Washington, this is Olympic Challenge Bowl 2. We're going to be right back.
This is Jack Schlichter with me of Western Airlines. Jack, what's this trophy?
Steve, this trophy we want on behalf of the 10,000 employees of Western Airlines to present to the winning coach.
Well, right now it's still up for grabs.
It certainly is, but both of these fine gentlemen are the best coaches in the land, and we'll be happy whichever one wins it.
Thank you, Jack.
All right, here we are back in action. Handoff. 21, Mike Kozlowski, he found big running room there. Had to be because the safety, number 31, Johnny Lynn from UCLA, had to make the tackle. The tides have changed here, Don, because it's just a completely different ball game right now than what it was, particularly in the second period. First down.
We often talk about that factor momentum, and it's obvious to not only we here in the booth, but surely all the people that are watching out there, that the Big 8 has had it here this second half.
quick screen. He got it underneath the arms of number 88, Jerry Wilkerson. See a lot of fingers being pointed down there. People are fighting and scratching for the football down at the bottom of that pile.
Bobby Kimball, the receiver on that one, and picked it, took it down for good yardage. 8-9 yard gain, but there is a big pile down there and a lot of people concerned. Evidently there was a fumble, but it looks like the big eight, if you can believe the players on the field, they have recovered and retained possession.
It's short of a first down, so they've still got a yard and a half to go for the first down, but they've got a couple of downs to do it in.
Big Abe Gibran looking a little concerned, a little angry.
Kozlowski once again is the ball carrier, and he's the man they give it to in tight, short yardage situations. This time he picked it up. Number 45, we've been talking about him all evening. Middle linebacker Bruce Beakley from Oregon come up with the stop. There he is, number 45, Bruce Beakley. He's been all over the field today, knocking down passes, making tackles. Thomas Lott slips. Nowhere to go. Wrapped up by number 88, Jerry Wilkerson, who's also been doing an outstanding job for the Pac-10 today.
There's Tom Lott coming off the field. Number 34 going on is Jimmy Rogers. And there's that big eight sideline there. They know they're back in the ball game.
They're a little more intent now. I remember the first half you looked at him, they thought, well, geez, let's get the plane out of here. But now they've... things just turned around, a little more spark on the sidelines. Sorley back to throw, in a crowd. 28, Ray Hardy was the intended man. Kim Anderson, number 22 from Arizona State, the defensive cornerback, making the defensive play. But I think that Ray Hardy probably felt he should have had that ball.
I think he probably should have. It looked like Anderson just stripped him of it. Hardy had it in his grasp. Good look at quarterback Tom Sorley, who's come on pretty well here in the second half. He was throwing it right into the midst of defensive linemen there for a while, but he started to use some finesse now, Len, and work around those guys.
Well, it just looks like that his whole attitude has changed, that he's more aggressive now. And he's looked out once again, 45, Bruce Beakley from Oregon, 6'1 and a half, 223, but he has the ability to get up in the air because that is at least the second pass that he has knocked down, which means that he's getting a pretty good drop back in the secondary, and that's the time that you can sneak those backs out of that backfield.
That's right. You better watch it. He'll get burned on that.
All right. They've got to kick the ball away, give it back to the Pac-10. 22, Kim Anderson. Really hasn't... Uh-oh. That's not the type of snap that you want. Billy, it did miracles before. You better get rid of it. It was such a bad, bad snap and went so far back that he was able to get rid of it. He comes out in great, great shape. 19-yard line. And he paid for it. He is down. More football action after this brief timeout. Ah, we're back now, Pac-10. They have the ball, 19-yard line, after that miraculous play by Billy Todd, the punter, who got it away. Game zone, right side. Blocker out in front. Good defensive play by number 17, Mike Clemens from Iowa State, the cornerback coming up to force that play, and that's not a very pleasant thing to do when you have some big offensive lineman like Tom Larson, 6'2", 240 pounds, coming out to block you.
Well, they call the special teams the suicide squad, but anytime you're a defensive back and you've got to force a running play with a guard leading it, to me, that's sure suicide. Head coach Bud Wilkinson of the St. Louis Cardinals, coaching the Big Eight All-Stars.
The man next to him is an outstanding coach, Tom Bettis. Coach with the Kansas City Chiefs for many years. Did a great job with the defense. Wait a minute. Yes, sir. There was a mix-up, definitely, because number 14, Jack Thompson, definitely did not want to end up with the football. But he's a veteran quarterback already. Do you notice him going down?
He can get to the ground in a hurry, can't he?
I think maybe that's because he had two shoulder operations, a bad knee, bad ankle, and has been beat up by playing quarterback at Washington State under, I believe, four different coaches during his career.
Anyway, he's going to make sure that doesn't happen anymore. He knows how to find that real estate.
He's going to have to go back and do it once again. By that, I'm talking about throw the football. Faking the play-action pass, going to his man, number 24, Calvin Sweeney, coming up with another outstanding catch. Another outstanding move. He's run that pattern, that deep in pattern, or whatever you want to call it.
Let's take a look at Cal Sweeney again. Earlier, he was working on Gary Irons. This time, it's number 17, Mike Clemens. He's beaten both of them. Sweeney from USC just doing an excellent job, and Thompson can find him.
That's why pressure on the quarterback is so important, because when you have outstanding receivers like we have out there, it's tough to cover them. If the quarterback has the time. 27th, the oldest Brown, trying to look for the outside. Good block by number 3, James Owens.
Oh, yeah, he did a good job. The Otis Brown, number 27, a big running back, 6'3", 218 from UCLA, doing a good job getting outside on that one. We mentioned number 3, James Owens, doing an excellent job of blocking. We also get another good block thrown by number 1 here, Severin Reese. Let's watch him, wide receiver setting up down there. And he gets into his man, forces him deep. Number 31 is Bill Fisher that he forced back.
First down, back 10. Bill Francis with the ball, Stanford, picking up a couple of yards. Going to come up with a second down situation now. We're looking at the clock now, and that is on the side right now, the team ahead, and that would be the Pac-10. They're ahead 29-23. The clock, 7 minutes remaining in this football game, as Bud Wilkinson looks on, saying that we've got to have the football before we can score. He's hoping that defensive unit of the Big 8 will be able to stop these men, and they haven't been able to stop that man, number 24, Calvin Sweeney. 27th, Otis Brown, looking for some running room, does not have it. Good play. Number 57, Jeff Lee from Colorado, linebacker, tripping up the Otis Brown, stopping him from making any gain.
Lennon, he did do an excellent job, because Jeff Lee was already down on the ground, but he was still fighting, got an arm up, and brought down the Otis Brown.
Bill Francis coming into the ball game from Stanford. As I said before, he's an excellent pass receiver, and he would be because Bill Walsh was his coach. Walsh now with the San Francisco 49ers. Pressure. Oh, great play by number 14, Jack Thompson, because 69, Chester Jeffery from K-State, the big defensive lineman, was pursuing. On the move, moving to his left, which is tough, getting the ball to Severin Reese, number 1. It's not easy to do for a quarterback who's right-handed to get chased out of the pocket and have to move to his left, and particularly when you have to get some depth away from one of those big linemen running away from the line of scrimmage to throw it, but Thompson has got a very, very strong arm. 24, Calvin Sweeney. Big part of this game. Number 3, a little room for James Owens, and it doesn't take much space for him to get through there, and once he gets through, he can really accelerate.
You know, not only is he smooth when he runs, watch him as he breaks back inside, but you see he runs with a lot of power. He's low to the ground, and right there he starts getting arm tackles laid on him, but he's running with a lot of determination. Good drive there. Look, he takes some guys for a ride there, and he only goes 190 pounds. Number 3, James Owens, world-class hurdler, sixth in the 1976 Olympic Games. Not a bad football player either.
Most track men that I have seen have great speed straight away, but
yeah,
they don't have that lateral movement, or they don't have the ability to stop and go like this young man does. Brown, up the middle, he's got running room. Picks up a first down. They're down near the 20-yard line of the Big 8. Number 69, Chester Jeffries, earning his wares or his keep today because he was involved in that play. K-State defensive lineman, 6'5", 255 pounds.
And the Pac-10 playing it close to the vest right now, getting a little conservative. 4:25 left in the fourth quarter of this game. They've got a six-point lead, and they want to preserve it.
Owens, right side, running hard with,
oh, wow.
Pretty good power just straight ahead for a man that really isn't that large. He's 6 feet, about 188 pounds, but picking up 5 yards at a crack, 5 yards on running plays, an excellent amount of yardage.
Theotis Brown just came into the lineup. Phil Francis goes out. Surely he's bringing in a play from head coach John McKay.
6 points ahead.
Second and 5.
3 minutes, 40 seconds counting down on the clock. 24, Calvin Sweeney. Done an excellent job. Not much that time. Defensive surge by the Big Eight was excellent that time. Bunging through there, number 77, Ken Bengarda from the University of Missouri. He's a big man, 6'6", 260 pounds. He got good penetration, along with number 76, Franklin King from the University of Kansas. It's amazing they play side by side because KU and MU, they don't get along very well during the season. Just shows what can happen when you come up here to Seattle.
Yeah.
Chamber of Commerce asked me to put that in. Two tight ends in the ball game. Theotis Brown to the outside. He's got speed. He's got the first down.
And not only that, Len, but he got a great block from number 3, James Owens, who was flanked that time, cut back, and really took out one of the Big Eight defenders.
Good tackle by number 31, William Fisher from K-State. Admit for him, I believe that number 27, Theotis Brown, would have said, we got 6.
He looks good. He runs tough up the middle, and that time it was a wide run, and carrying 223 pounds, he does a good job. 218 pounds, shows a lot of speed in getting to the outside.
He's heavier than that right now. He was that during the season. He's up around 235 when they weighed him in the other day. Maybe that was after they ate all those pizzas, though. Straight up the middle, 37, Phil Francis from Stanford, picking up a couple of tough yards down there near the goal line. Number 86, Ron Suda from the University of Missouri, involved in that tackle. As you look at the sidelines, and Coach John McKay is trying to figure out, what play am I going to call to get us into the end zone?
Len, do the coaches, Wilkinson and McKay, have an added advantage over the others in the NFL as far as scouting these guys because they're coaching them?
Oh, yes, 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 they do, because they can see what they can learn in the meetings, and they know that, you know, they can teach him and practice in practice, you know, the techniques and fundamentals that they want to see. Theotis Brown fighting his way, getting down, balls pop loose, hands are being waved down there, signaling going the other way, and the Big Eight comes up with a very big turnover with 1 minute and 40 seconds remaining in this ball game.
I tell you what, Len, it's a big turnover, but it's a long way to go with a minute 40 left. There's the man coming off with the ball, Chester Jeffrey. He recovered it for the Big Eight.
Earlier today, Steve Grad announced the winners of the Toyota Olympia Challenge Bowl sweepstakes.
It's now time for the announcement of the winners of the Toyota Olympia Challenge Bowl sweepstakes. For the past 3 weeks, the Puget Sound area Toyota dealers have been offering this beautiful Celica GT liftback as the grand prize. And the winners this year are Mr. and Mrs. Larry Shreve of Seattle, Washington. And here to present the title and the keys to this beautiful new Toyota are Puget Sound area Toyota dealers Glenn Sawyer, Frank Kinney, and Mike Brower.
Thanks, Steve. Mrs. Shreve, here is the title to your new Celica liftback and our best wishes for 1979.
Thank you very much.
And Mr. Shreve, here are the keys to your new car. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you all very much. Now let's go back to the game.
All right, that ball is nestled down there around the 2-yard line. We've got a minute and 40 seconds remaining in this ball game. There's 6 points separating the two teams.
Bill Fisher, number 31 there on your screen, was shaken up a little on that last play for the Big Eight. We hope Bill's going to be all right. Looks like he's getting some smelling salts, so evidently he got his head shook up a little bit.
Tony back to throw, deep in the end zone, looking for some help. No, sir, too far. Third interception for number 22, Kim Anderson. The ball was
completely overthrown. He's down to where they had it just a moment ago on about the 1 or the 2 yard line.
Well, quarterback Sorley really had no choice. He had to put the ball up in the air. He had to gamble a little bit. We've got a player down on the field injured, but Tom was getting hit right there as he got the ball off, could not follow through. The ball was underthrown. Kim Anderson doing a good job. He's playing deep. And watch this run going back. He looks like he'd make a good running back. I'm sure the pro scouts here are watching him. There's a lot of bit of fancy footwork there, shifting down inside the 5-yard line to the 2-yard line for the Pac-10.
We'll return to Olympia Challenge Bowl 2 right after this brief timeout. Well, we're back where we started, I think, one play ago on the 2-yard line. The Pac-10 now has the football. They gave it up on a fumble the last time, but they came up with a big interception. That last play, Mike Kozlowski, number 21 of the Big 8, was injured, but he walked off the field. High formation. We've got Lynn Kane getting the ball, fighting his way. He's in for a touchdown. Lynn Kane going in 2 yards. Number 21 from USC, 6'1", 204 pounds. He had an outstanding career at USC. Now they have the option, Don, to go for 1 point or 2 points. 35-23 is the score right now.
And that much pretty much puts the lid on it for the Pac-10.
Paul Watson. It's up. It's good. So it's 36-23, a 13-point lead with 1 minute and 23 seconds remaining in this football game. But don't count it out, because we've seen some crazy things happen here this evening, and people, our teams are capable of striking in a hurry because both teams have speed on the outside.
Lynn, while we got a minute here and the teams are going out on the field, Jack Thompson has been named offensive player of the game, and as a result of that, he wins a trip for two to the Caribbean. So a pretty good thing. Kim Anderson was named defensive player of the game.
Where does he win? Where does he get to go?
Yeah, well,
Kansas City, they just had about 14 inches of snow. Had some outstanding performances here on both sides. And I think a lot of these young men have gained in what the pros are looking at as far as the draft is concerned, that they have proven that they are capable of doing certain things that the pros are looking for. For one, for everybody knows now that Jack Thompson all over the country is a pro quarterback, that he can play in the pros. He's got the tools to do it.
Got the good arm, the quick feet, and he can find his receivers.
And he has some outstanding ones. Calvin Sweeney, number 24 from USC. I think you said that you know, he didn't really get that much of an opportunity at USC to catch the football, but he's displayed today that he definitely can catch it, catch it in a crowd. He's got the speed and the concentration to be an outstanding receiver. Paul Watson to kick off. Line driving it. Ray Hardy, number 28, gets a hold of it. Not much to go. 37, Phil Francis, fullback from Stanford, made the stop. And he's a good team or special team man, because he's been involved in a lot of tackles on the special teams. And for rookies going into professional football, that is very, very important, because if you can't start on a pro team in the National Football League, you had better do an outstanding job on the special teams. Minucci's a quarterback. Screen pass. Thomas Lott.
With me is Earl McLaren of Dean Witter Reynolds. And who is the most valuable player?
Steve, it was Jack Thompson of Washington State. He'll receive the Dean Witter Reynolds Most Valuable Trophy Award. He'll also receive a trip to the Caribbean via Western Airlines.
He put on quite a performance. Thank you very much, Earl.
Thank you.
It's back to live action. 10 yards to go for a first down, but more importantly, 1 minute, 11 seconds remaining in this ball game. And he had intentions of going to Bobby Kimball, number 22, but number 25, John Piggott, a safety man, had other ideas. The 5'11", 170-pound
safety from Stanford was there, and I'm sure he's feeling that I should have come up with the football.
Almost tipped it back to Kim Anderson. Piggott didn't get it, but he tipped it in the air. Anderson had another shot at it. Anderson has already picked off three today.
I would think that they'd go the other direction if 22 Anderson picked off three. I'd find some other place to throw it. Split backfield. They'll be going back to pass. It's third down and 10. Minucci's back to throw. Over the middle. He's got his big tight end, Victor Hicks. Big tight end is mad because he didn't make more yards. He was stopped by linebacker number 53, Gary Cobb, out of USC. But he's smiling. He knows he's going to the Caribbean. Dak Thompson. Outstanding evening for the Pac-10.
Well, Len, you know the way he looked here this evening, he might be able to buy the Caribbean.
Yes.
How high do you think he'll go in the first round of the draft, if the first round?
Depends. I think a quarterback, it depends on the need of a team. If a team needs a quarterback, and particularly I think in his case, since he's been injured, a team that has the nucleus of a good football team, he would be excellent to go with. Because here's the situation, not a very good one for the Big 8. 52 seconds remaining. They've got fourth down and a few inches to go, and they are down 36-23, 13 points to the Pac-10. They need points. They need them in a very big hurry, but they also need a first down. They've got it with the quarterback, I think, struggling forward. In the ball game is number 10, Dan Minucci from K-State. If he got the first down, the clock will stop until they move the chains. That's a college rule, so they're not going to waste much time on that last play. Be able to get the ball off. The lineman ought to get down and be ready. Out the lot, number 6. Good move to get toward the sidelines, and he should get out of bounds. An excellent move by number 6, the ex-quarterback, Thomas Lott.
He got all the yardage possible out of that one before going out of bounds. Picked up the first and 10, though, for the Big 8.
35 seconds remaining in this football game. As I said, 13 points. That's the number that they've got to catch up. The Big 8, they're down to the Pac-10, 36-23. Big 8 has done a very fine job in the second half coming back. Over the middle, great throw, great catch by number 28, Ray Hardy. That's a first down. That'll stop the clock until they move the chains. Man is down on the field. Number 31, safety, Johnny Lynn.
He was the guy that made the stop that time on Ray Hardy, and he came out on the short end of it. Number 31, Johnny Lynn, defensive back from UCLA, down on the field out there. He doesn't have to say hi, Mom. She's right there holding him.
The youngsters do like this game, don't they? There's 27 seconds remaining in this football game. First and 10 for the Big 8, and I'm sure what they're thinking, in particular, number 10, Dan Minucci, who hasn't had an opportunity to do too much today, that he'd like to get into the end zone to prove that, he also can throw that ball and also can lead a football team. I thought he did a tremendous job at Kansas State this year. They were tied for third place in the Big 8, and here's a team that has had nothing but problems the last few years.
You know, it's interesting, the states of Texas and Oklahoma, their universities, their population always have a friendly rivalry about who's going in to recruit from somebody else. Thomas Lott and Victor Hicks, both with Oklahoma, are both from Texas, and when they left the state, a lot of fans, especially in the San Antonio area where Thomas Lott was from, are quite incensed. How do we let them get away? But of course, all states feel that way. But
you're talking about two states that take football very, very seriously. There's a man that takes it seriously. He's had wisdom teeth problem this week, Don, and I know he wants to get out of town, get back to Tampa to see his dentist or wherever his dentist lives. And I'm sure he's very happy with the performance of these young men that he's coached this week. I'm talking about John McKay, who really had a tremendous career at USC. Took over in 1960. In 16 years, he won 127, lost 40, and tied 8. 3 undefeated teams, 4 national titles, 8 Rose Bowl appearances, he won 5. 40 All-Americans that he coached, including 2 Heisman Trophy Award winners, Mike Garrett and O.J. Simpson.
He spent some time at your alma mater, didn't he, Purdue, as a freshman, I believe?
That was way before my time. Yeah, he was there probably with Abe Gibron.
Just a couple of years before you, I think, Lenny.
Injured player coming off the field's number 31, Johnny Lynn, defensive back from UCLA, being assisted there by the trainers. Appears to have a neck injury. He's holding his head there like it can't move a little bit even.
Well, at least it's when you can walk off the field, as you know as well as I, that's somewhat encouraging. There's a lot, they're all in pain down there because they've been knocking each other down for almost 60 minutes. Minucci back to throw. Going across the middle. Intended, I believe, for number 22, Billy Kimball, but it wasn't very close. Number 50, George Yarno, who is now on defense, who was on offense. He played defense during the course of the year, but because of the shortage of offensive linemen, he had to make the switch and turn it around. He did a fine job today.
His brother John is the Seattle Seahawks center here for the pro football team, so he comes from a good football family. Second and 10.
22 seconds remaining. Second and 10. Ball's on the 29-yard line. Minucci back to throw. Going to the sidelines. Got his man, number 24, and that's Charlie Green, his teammate. 17 seconds remaining on the clock. First and 10, 18-yard line. Bobby Kimball coming in with a play. And the man who just received the last pass, number 24, Charlie Green, coming out. Dropping it out to Rogers. Shakes the tackle. They get in. No, he's out of bounds on about the 4-yard line. Driven out by number 84 linebacker Jerry Robinson from UCLA and number 47 Larry Brazil from USC. So Jimmy Rogers, number 34 from Oklahoma, carrying the ball down to the 4-yard line. There are 8 seconds remaining in this football game. And the one thing that Dan Minucci wants to do is put it in the end zone.
Lynn, this has to be a world record for a two-minute period. I think this last 2 minutes of this ball game has taken about 17 minutes of actual time.
Well, you know, it makes a difference when they stop the clock after every first down. No, sir. Movement.
Let's see if we can see who moves first here. We're looking at, well,
number 63, Sam.
We got Sam Clapham moving up. Yeah. Defensive guy, you can move. The offense, you cannot. It's got to be a little bit intimidating to be nose to nose and that defensive guy flinch at you. You know, it's going to cause a reaction, I'm sure.
Really didn't affect much because they're down deep. They don't have that much working room anyway. 8 seconds remaining. You know they're going to throw the football. And whether they go in from 4 yards or 9 yards doesn't make that much difference. Nobody open. He should have thrown that ball away. 2 yep. seconds, 1 second, no time left. It's all over. 36-23, Pac-10 defeating the Big 8. That's the end of the 1979 Olympia College Bowl. Number 2 with the final score, Pac-10 36, Big 8 23. Thanks for joining us.
Promotional consideration provided by the Washington Plaza, Seattle's finest and most spectacular hotel. The next time travel brings you to Seattle, stay at the Washington Plaza, a Western International hotel. Theragran high potency vitamins supplied to the U.S. Olympic Committee and the vitamins most recommended by physicians and pharmacists. Theragran and Theragran M with minerals. Royal Down, creators of a complete line of quality rugged outerwear distributed worldwide.
there, but I think Curtis Cohn got the brunt of the blow on that when he gets sent back about.
Pressure because he's had a couple of operations. He had both shoulders operated on, and also he's got a knee problem.
That was the most pressure that Thompson's had put on him all evening. Here he rolls out, gets a little bit right there as the pressure from Franklin came.